Wow is wow. Okay, doing a little exercise there. Welcome to the video. Wow is wow. Okay, welcome to Wow is Wow. Welcome to Wow is Wow. And I thank everyone for their silence. That's great. No comments, no nothing, just silence, which is awesome. So here we go. Kicking off the tribulation period here with the eclipse, 21st of August, 7-year tribulation period. And so what we have prepared is a way to get through this, okay? Very simple, just a way to get through the next 7 years. So as you're watching this video, it's a way to get through the next 7 years, all right? And so we have these various talking points about this that for you to begin to assimilate. I have a few talking points I wrote down, actually, and just in no particular order, I'll go through them. Cap expectations. Okay. We're going to cap expectations during the next 7 years. No ultimate liberation. Okay. No ultimate liberation. No ultimate liberation. It, you know, if it happens, it happens, right? But our expectations are capped, and so we're not aiming for ultimate liberation. Okay, we're not aiming for ultimate liberation. We're just aiming for wow. We're just aiming for wow. Wow is wow. Wow is wow. During the next 7 years, at the end of the 7 years, probably we won't be ultimately enlightened. Okay, that's fine. Cap your expectations. What, 2024, we'll still be what? We'll still be suffering. To believe that you have a life is to suffer. Okay, plain and simple. To believe that you're born is to suffer. There's no way around that whatsoever. So, with that in mind, the next key point would be accept your suffering. Accept your suffering. Accept it. Accept that life is suffering. Plain and simple. Life is suffering. That's all that it is. So don't try to make yourself happy. That's a mistake. That's the big mistake we make. What we want to do is we want to minimize our suffering, okay? We want to minimize our suffering, to minimize it, minimize it. We don't want to get rid of it, okay? We don't want to try and be happy. It's impossible. As long as we believe that we've been born, it's impossible to be happy, totally impossible, okay? And we want to cap our expectations so that we stop at the wow. Wow is wow. Have we been born or have we not been born? We just take the position of wow on this, okay? This is our aim for the next 7 years. Let anyone else say what they want to say, okay? But there's a reason why we're capping our expectations. So we want to avoid the worst of it. We want to avoid the worst of it in these next 7 years. We want to avoid the worst of our suffering. Talking point. So we've had several talking points. Cap our expectations, accept our suffering, avoid the worst of it. That's kind of a root formulation right here, isn't it? Cap our expectations, accept our suffering. Okay, as our root, basic root is suffering. I'm suffering. That's fine. Okay, accept your suffering. So someone says, how are you today? So I'm suffering. To be alive is to suffer, so I'm suffering. But I'm working on avoiding the worst of it. Great. So we're trying to avoid the worst of it. So there's a formulation right there. Cap expectations, accept your suffering, avoid the worst of it. Okay. So we've got that root formulation there. Let's see if we should... Oh, okay, yeah. Now, how do we avoid the worst of it? How do we avoid the worst of it? That would be the next question, right? Okay, great. So, cap expectations. I'm still going to be suffering. At the end of 7 years, I'm still going to be feeling some suffering, okay? I'll still be suffering then. Okay, so I've capped my expectations. And I'm going to accept for the next 7 years that I'm going to suffer. Okay, fine. But I'm going to do what I need to do to avoid the worst of it. To avoid the worst of it. How do we do that? Okay, so this is the key now. Now we're getting into the practice phase of it. The practice formulation is you accept a life of shock. Accept a life of shock instead of panic. Okay, so this is really key now. So how do root formulation, now the practice formulation. How do we do this? Accept a life of shock. Wow. Wow, the shock. Wow, the shock. Okay. And wow, the wow. Okay. Accept a life of shock. Wow, the shock. And then wow, the wow. That's how we avoid the worst of our suffering during the next 7 years. So, accept a life of shock for the next 7 years. Wow, the shock. And then wow, the wow. There you go. Wow. Yeah. Now, chronic does not mean normal. Okay, this is a key point also. A key leverage point, okay, a key leverage point, a mindfulness point, a very key mindfulness point, leverage. Chronic doesn't mean normal. 100% minus, this is another phrase we'll use, 100% minus, meaning everybody. But we leave that easement of minus. Okay, we don't point out well exceptions to this, but it's a compassionate way of saying everybody minus, 100% minus. Okay, this is a way that we can talk. 100% minus. Chronic doesn't mean normal. 100% minus are in a chronic state of panic, actually. They're in a chronic state of panic. A few of us, 100% minus, are the ones who have accepted a life of shock. Okay, to accept a life of shock is a bridge to ultimate realization, to all that nothing has ever been born. No universe has been born, no worlds have been born, no suns, no stars, no people, no nature, nothing is ever born at all. There's no such thing as life, quote unquote, born life, life that is born. Okay. There's just the one unborn life. Okay. But you don't even call it life because we're used to. There's just the one unbornness, perfect, ultimate, perfect unbornness. There's only that, actually, ultimately. So shock, a life of shock, is a bridge from panic to peace. It's the bridge from panic to peace. To realize that nothing has been born is peace. There's no suffering there. Okay. But first, you have to accept a life of shock. And then wow the shock so it doesn't go back into panic. So the world, 100% minus of the world, has been chronically in a state of panic for unbelievable amount of familiarity. Okay, unbelievable amount of familiarity. They've been working at it and working at it and working at it. And they have vast familiarity with being in a state of panic. So it's chronic panic for 100% minus in this world. Chronic panic. Realize this. And the mistake that is made by 100% minus, the mistake is to believe that chronic means normal. Okay, so what we do is this one differentiation. Chronic isn't normal, doesn't mean normal. Okay, chronic doesn't mean normal. They're completely different. Panic is actually utterly abnormal for us. And peace is normal for us. But chronic doesn't mean normal. Okay, we're in a chronic state of panic. It doesn't mean that's normal. It's totally abnormal, but it's chronic. So we need a bridge out of that chronic state of panic that we've been in for so long to peace. And that bridge is shock. That bridge is shock. Shock is still suffering, okay? But it's suffering that enables us to gain clarity about the fact that nothing's ever been born. There's no such thing as being born. It's able to gain that ultimate clarity. You're able to practice. In a state of shock, you're able to practice in the right way. You're able to allow the clearing up to happen. Because it's shocking. The clearing up is very shocking. So you live a life of shock. As the delusion is clearing up, it's very shocking. The key is to not go back into that chronic state of panic, which we're so, familiar with, and therefore we expect to be in a state of panic because we think it's normal. It's not. It's chronic. So we can live a life of shock. I've lived a life of shock. That's why I'm able to do these videos. I decided when I was 12 years old that I was going to take this path of suffering, a conscious suffering of shock, okay? And I knew that would make me ostracized from the rest of the world, 100% minus of those here, because they were in a chronic state of panic, and I wasn't in a chronic state of panic anymore. I was in a state of shock, different state, different mood. Conscious, much more conscious. I'm aware of the shock. I'm conscious of it. I'm aware of it trying to go back into panic. I'm aware of the clarity that's causing the shock. Okay, so it's a bridge-like consciousness. It's a bridge-like consciousness. So I've now, in my 50th year of that, in my 50th year now, started my 50th year today, of a life of shock. A life of shock enables us to get familiar with truth. It enables us to get familiar with truth, whereas panic does not allow us to get familiar with truth. Panic can listen to truth, but it's in one ear and out the other. Panic can do practices, but it's in one ear and out the other. Panic can be spiritual, but it's still superficial, one in one ear out. Gone like that. So panic cannot get familiar with truth. It can hear it, but it cannot. It disallows familiarity. It stays familiar with what? It stays familiar with panic. Panic is its god. The god of panic is panic. It's, yes. And it believes that God is a god of panic, and that's what God wants us, and believes this is normality. We're supposed to stay that way. No, it's chronicness. It's chronic. Abnormality, chronic abnormality, but the familiarity is set in such that we believe this must be normal, this must be true, this must be what God wants, this must be, you know, and we can't get away from that. So shock seems like abnormal. We say, oh my, I can't do that. See, so we've got it up, we have it upside down and backwards because we've taken the chronic abnormality to mean normality. So this is the really key pivot to. For our formulation, what? To avoid the worst of it. Cap our expectations, accept a life of suffering, but avoid the worst of it right now for this next 7 years. Avoid the worst of it. Chronic abnormality is not normality. Okay. Totally different. Shock, a life of shock is the bridge to normality. It's the bridge to normality. So accept a life of shock. Now, is it suffering? Yes, absolutely it's suffering. But it's the suffering that enables genuine familiarity with truth to take place. And familiarity is our entire problem. The familiarity problem is our entire problem. So chronic abnormality is not the same as normality. The familiarity problem is our entire problem. It's what expectation, the expectation familiarity problem is our entire problem. We don't have any other problem. And shock, a life of shock, is the bridge between abnormality and normality. So those are three key formulations there. And of course, we'll go over these formulations. They're just this is the basics. We're going over the basics. How to avoid the worst of it. realize that chronic abnormality is not normality. We need to, so therefore we need to go from abnormality to normality. How do we do that? Accept a life of shock. That's the bridge. Accept a life of shock. That's the bridge. And is that a life of suffering? Yes, but it enables familiarity with truth. So familiarity is decisive. Okay, that's the third formulation. Familiarity is decisive. Familiarity problem is the only problem I have, and familiarity is decisive. It's really decisive. So chronic abnormality is not normal. Accept a life of shock. Familiarity is decisive. This is how we avoid the worst of it. Now, there may be some of you listening, maybe nobody listening here will do this. Wow is wow. Wow is the way. Wow is the way, and wow is wow. Or maybe some of you will. Maybe all of you will. Maybe some of you will. Maybe none of you will. I don't know. And yet still, we have this. We have this. Okay? We have this. This is a result of advanced foresight. I use my foresight, the foresight, spiritual foresight, to prepare these formulations for everyone so that we would have the ability to get through these next 7 years and avoid the worst of it. Avoid the worst of it. Wow. Yeah, wow. So I'm just putting this out so we can start getting used to it. And how do I feel? I feel wow. It means not bad or not good. We're not saying what. Wow is the indeterminate determinate. The indeterminate determinate. The indeterminate determinate. And what does wow mean? Wow means wow. So it's intentionally left as an indeterminate determinant. It's like an undefined definition. It's an undefined definition, okay? And this is absolutely vitally important. We need to do this to honor our creativity. The reason why we don't accept ultimacy, true peace of mind, is because the familiarity problem. But even deeper than that is the compassion we must have for ourselves, the love of our cleverness in trying to change reality. This whole dream of a universe is our attempt to change what we are. And we've been so creative with this that we love our creativity. And even though we're suffering, the love of our creativity is so strong that we're not willing to set our suffering down. Not directly. So we honor our creativity by a indefinite definition. An indefinite definition. Wow. What we have done is wow. Okay, what we have done is wow. We're not going to say we've done nothing or we've done something. Okay, that's too extreme. That's too extreme. Ultimately, it will all just dissolve. Okay, once we have gone through all of this, a frame of reference shift will just happen, ultimately. So we don't need to worry about trying to make it happen or anything like that. We have to be willing to say, okay, ready to move on from this attempt to change, you know, what we are. Attempt to define what we are. Reality is completely undefinable. There's absolutely no definition of reality whatsoever. Okay, it cannot be defined. The infinite freedom there's no definition for it. And we cannot limit or define what we are. It's impossible. But we've tried, and we've tried to such an extent, a whole universe of trying, that it takes a while for us to be willing to just say, okay, I'm ready now to realize that nothing ever happened. Because we've been so creative, right? So we're not trying to reach that ultimacy. It's a great mistake to try and reach ultimacy. That's trying to force things, and then you're really going to suffer badly. We accept the fact that we will keep suffering simply because really our love of our cleverness. We love mystery and cleverness. We've been engaged in that so long. The mystery is, well, how do we do this? You know, it's a great mystery. How do we change what we are? Well, we can't. But we thought it was a mystery to be solved. And now we realize it's just, wow. We solved the mystery. Okay, we solved the mystery, and it's wow. So this great mystery of how do we change what we are, we've solved it, and it's an indefinite definition. So can we define what we are? The answer is wow. I mean, it's an indefinite definition. And this is just a way of honoring our creativity, the love of our creativity. And then we take that love of our creativity into ultimately, but again, next 7 years, we're going to still be suffering, okay? It's just a basic acceptance. And for most of us, the rest of our lives, it will lead a life of suffering. Virtually 100% minus who've ever come into this world, 100% minus lead a life, an entire life, they suffer. I've never met anyone that hasn't led a life of suffering their entire life. I've never met anyone. There's a few who didn't, and they stand out, like Ram Maharshi. He didn't suffer, for instance. He didn't lead a life of suffering. That's an example. There's a few other examples. But other than these, you know, that's 100% minus. Okay, so there's a few. Very, 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 very few. So, the next 7 years, we will all be suffering together, all right? And if an anomaly comes up, then an anomaly comes up. We will leave that 100% minus in there in case there happens to be an anomaly. But anomalies don't change the formulation that's 100% minus, do they? They don't change that. So, chronic abnormality is not normal, and 100% minus. These are nice little catchphrases that we're going to use to avoid the worst of it. That's all. We're just going to avoid the worst of it. So it's really founded on this not positivity here, but suffering. We accept our suffering. And then we just very, 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 with steady determination, do everything we can to avoid the worst of it. And guess what? We will avoid the worst of it by taking this path, by doing this discipline. We will avoid the worst of it. That doesn't mean we won't be suffering. We will. Just breathing is suffering. Moving is suffering. Sitting is suffering. Everything is suffering. We want to avoid trying to end suffering. Okay, we're not trying to be happy. We're not attempting to be happy. That's the great mistake of these times, and all times of life, is the attempt to try and be happy. This brings then worse suffering. It's like working out too much, and then 3 or 4 days later, you just feel horrible. Horrible. Just feel so bad. You overdid it. So, trying to have a life and not suffer is a recipe for hideous suffering, actually. Happiness should never be an attainment. It's never a goal or an attainment, okay? It's normal. This just means normalcy. And that can never be a goal or an attainment. What we have to do is focus on suffering and minimize and avoid the worst of it. But don't try to get rid of it. Don't try to get rid of it. And so that's why drugs are so bad. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll, really bad. You have to avoid that during these next 7 years. You have to avoid any attempt to induce happiness. Okay? Do not try to induce happiness. What we're doing is we're working on familiarity, and familiarity is decisive. Okay, so after 7 years of working on this familiarity with truth, by accepting a life of shock, guess what? We're going to be that much closer, right? We're setting ourselves up for ultimacy, for a frame of reference shift. We're setting ourselves up beautifully for that. And so we use the 7 years in the best way possible. So these 7 years is a very dangerous time, because so many will try to induce happiness during this time. So many will, the path of trying to induce happiness, this is what will cause them to be swept away back into the arms of chronic panic, thinking that it's normal. It's like those who are in a state of chronic panic are trying to be happy in the state of chronic panic. That's not possible. It's not possible. Those who believe they're born are trying to be happy with life. That's impossible. And the more you try to force it, the more life you think you need. You see? Right? You say, well, I don't have enough life to be happy. I have to be born many times to gain the happiness. And it just perpetuates this terrible cycle. And we're also not trying to induce suffering. So suffering is a given. As long as we believe that anything has ever been born, that there's ever been any life at all, we can't help but suffer. It's a fear-based belief system. So we don't try to induce suffering to get rid of suffering. Okay? You don't try to induce suffering to get rid of suffering. That's a big mistake. You neither try to induce suffering nor try to induce happiness. You just accept your suffering, whatever it happens to be. And view it from a state of shock. View it from a state of shock. I'm suffering. Wow. I'm suffering. Wow. And so you view it from a creative standpoint of a indefinite definite. An indefinite definite. An undefined definition. An undefined definition. I'm suffering. Wow. Undefined definition. Because the suffering is really a product of our creativity, our cleverness, in imagining that we were born. So don't fight against it. Don't try to change it. Just accept it from the standpoint of the bridge between abnormality and normality, which is shock. I'm suffering. Wow. A undefined definition. An undefined definition, which is a tip of the hat to our creativity of attempting to define what we are, which would be an attempt to change what we are so that we can be, you know, different than God, have a different creation best based on limitation and definition. Tip your hat and say, you know, I've been fabulously creative. So my definition it's an undefined definition. It's an undefined, and we leave it. So wow is wow. Meaning, how do you define wow? Wow is how we define wow. And how do we define that? Wow. It just goes in circles. Just wow is wow is wow is wow is wow. So wow is wow is wow is wow is wow is wow is wow. Wow is wow. Wow is wow is wow is wow is wow. Nice little practice there. If you want to do practice, if you want to hold something while you're practicing, just wow is wow is wow. 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 Wow. You can pick this up and just say, wow is wow. I also have a little practice ball. So this is just wow. Wow. So all creativity, all this creativity in all directions that we have used to believe that anything can be born at all, that there's any sort of birth causation, that one thing comes out from another that way and then separates from it, okay, as a birth. All the creativity is wow. The creativity is wow. Just as all these different little, you could even get one of these. I saw the physical therapist place had one of these. Headstrom ball bounce and sport ball bounce is very nice little device. So this reminds you that all our creativity is wow. I'm defining it as wow. This is all our creativity, all this attempt to delude ourselves is super creative. Look at the universe, how you can see the reflection of our own creativity. Okay, and then this little thing is just wow is wow. We remind ourselves, wow is wow. Wow is wow. Wow is wow. Wow is wow. Wonderful little devices here. So, avoiding the worst of it. Yeah. You know, at some point in the next 7 years, there may be a lot of people who accept this, these formulations. Okay. Accept a life of shock. There may be a lot, maybe not many at first, but as the 7 years goes on, there may be a lot of us say, hey, you know what? Avoiding the worst of it is really wise. It's really, really wise. It's not the time to go for ultimacy. And it's never the time to try to induce happiness. Never try to induce happiness. Because then you abandon the state of shock. You're trying to abandon the state of shock. You can't be happy when you're in a state of shock. Okay. You try to abandon. And when you try to abandon the state of shock, what happens is there's no more bridge. So it's either perfect happiness that never ends or panic. You see? And what happens? Expectations. The invisible bars of expectation and familiarity will pull us back into panic. And then it feels like we've fallen, and then we get really despondent, and then we try to induce happiness. Then we go back into the problem of inducing happiness, which overstrains us, overburdens us, and then our suffering becomes terrible, and then we get in a negative cycle, and that's when you hit the sex, the drugs, and the rock and roll very, very severely. Okay? That's just a phrase, formulation for disaster in your life, actually. Trying to induce happiness is the great mistake. So we don't try to induce happiness. Happiness will automatically be there when the frame of reference shift takes place and it shifts to normal. But we will never get there unless we accept a life of shock first and hold on to that life of shock and don't try to get rid of it. Don't try to get rid of it. Accept it. Accept your suffering. Accept your suffering. Be humble. Accept your suffering. I'm a poor sufferer. You can say I'm a Dharma prince or a Dharma princess, a lowly Dharma prince or a lowly Dharma princess, if you want. Meaning you've accepted life a shock. To be a Dharma prince is accept a life a shock. Okay, Dharma kings have realized nothing's ever been born. Nothing can ever be born. There is no quote unquote life at all. There's just the one, just the is. The one is. Okay. Those are the Dharma kings. And we're not trying to be Dharma kings during the next 7 years. We're trying to be the best Dharma prince and princess we can. But that means that we're accepting a life of shock and we're suffering. We've accepted our suffering. And we're not trying to induce happiness. Get this? Not trying to induce happiness. Nor trying to get rid of suffering by trying to experience massive suffering right now, as if that can somehow get rid of it. No, as long as we believe we were born, anything can be born, not just us, anything at all, we are going to continue to suffer. So it's impossible to get rid of suffering. So trying to say if I just suffer hideously, torture myself, then I paid the price and now I can be rid of suffering, that doesn't work. Doesn't work at all. It's like crucifying yourself, thinking that's going to save you. Okay? No, because you still believe that you were born. You still believe that others, anything could be born. So you have not freed yourself from suffering at all. So we neither crucify ourselves nor try to induce happiness. We stay right in the wow. The way of wow is to accept a life of shock. Now these times are very shocking, but if we've accepted a life of shock, then we just wow it. We just have our practice, and we can sail through it. We can just sail through it without trying to crucify ourselves, meaning induce suffering, nor try to induce happiness. No crucifixion, no sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Okay, neither one. So we're just a blah, lowly suffering princess, or a blah, lowly suffering Dharma prince. See, Dharma princess, Dharma prince. We're just a lowly, suffering Dharma prince or princess in shock. And we're staying in shock. We're in no hurry to leave shock. We're in no hurry to leave it. We just have steady determination to get familiar with truth, and ultimately a frame of reference shift will take place, ultimately. And that'll be it. Once that frame of reference shift takes place, normality. That's all. Trying to induce normality just sets up a duality, you know, that you're not normal. You've been born. You're someone who's been born who's trying to become unborn. No. See, that never works. Never works. We have to be simply familiar with the realization that nothing has ever been born. And this gradually seeps into us. It gradually seeps into us. You'll see it. You'll see it maybe just for an instant like that. And you'll say, oh, I just saw it. Wow, wow. And then just go right back into shock. Okay, shock. Okay, go back into shock. And stabilize in the shock. Don't block the panic. Don't go back into panic. Don't try to induce a frame of reference shift directly. Don't try to induce it. Be very careful about practicing. If we practice, you have to practice in the mode of shock, meaning I'm going to go back to shock. I'm practicing from the context of shock, not trying to leap from panic into reality, to peace. But so we can practice affirmations, except like that, but it has to be done realizing whatever results I get doesn't matter. I'm just still going to honor my creativity. I have a undefined definition of whatever happens, even if I, you know, enlightenment dawns or whatever, we get glimpses of it, it's still, right, stay in shock, undefined definition. You stay lowly like this. You don't grab a hold of it and try to then induce peace of mind. Peace of mind is never induced. It only is truly experienced as stable when the frame of reference shift happens. When the frame of reference shift happens, then it's stable. It's stable. There's nothing to do. It's just, that's it, you know. So we should simply keep working on familiarity, and that's what induces frame of reference shift. Okay, don't try to induce the results of a frame of reference shift. Try to induce the frame of reference shift, and that is done through familiarity. Because once that happens, the results are automatic. Results are automatic, which is just normalcy. And there's nothing to add to normalcy. Normalcy is what can induce normalcy? To try and induce it means there's something other than it, right? And that's not true. So the more we try to induce normality, the more we set up this dichotomy of abnormality. So that's a panic type of approach. A lot of approaches are panic based and they don't work. And ultimately they lead to the sex, the drugs, and the rock and roll, don't they? Absolutely they do. The weirdness, right? Like, I got to induce happiness to panic. Again, taking chronic abnormality as normality, and then saying there's something wrong. If I can, I got to induce happiness into abnormality. In other words, they're saying I've got to make the abnormal normal. It's not normal enough. Meaning what? I have to get more familiar with it. Which means what? Staying on the wheel of transmigration. Staying on the wheel of rebirth. Which is believing that anything can be born at all. To believe that anything can be born at all is to believe that you're in a realm of births, lives, which is suffering. So to try and to make abnormal normal, meaning chronic, more chronic, it requires even more familiarity with panic, which is to believe that you were born, anything is born, anything at all has been born. So you'll continue on with this dream of life, a dream of life, of lives. There's just the one life, which just is, okay, just is. And that is something, we cannot induce that into abnormality and make abnormality the new isness. Again, when we try to do that, we're only trying to become more familiar with abnormality and make it like perfectly chronic. Which means we just have to keep waiting and keep ourselves in this belief of there's all these lives taking place, which is hideous suffering to believe such a thing. Because, not because, it just... Chronic doesn't mean normal, right? Chronic abnormality is not normal. It's not normality. So the universe is an attempt to change what we are. That's what it is. It's our game. God has nothing to do with this, with universes at all. Universes, of course, are what? Limitation, definition, attempt to define, to limit. Here's a star, here's a planet, here's a galaxy, here's space between the two, here's this. That's all attempt to define what we are. So it's our, we're spirit, we're extension of the idea in the mind of God, which we call that spirit, if you want to call it that, mind, spirit, consciousness, awareness, call it awareness, whatever. But we're an extension of the Prime Creator. And when we try to change reality, which is what we're trying to do, we try to limit it, define it. And so this dream of a universe is just our attempt to change reality. It's all it is. It's an attempt to come up with something. It's a mystery. We don't know what exactly it is, but we're trying to discover something, some force, some dynamic, some situation, some pressure, some agency that actually can change reality and bind moments together and bind freedom, this moment of pure freedom and this moment of pure freedom, and somehow connect the two. To unify the two. So the attempt to unify, to believe in a universe, and then attempt to unify is delusion. It's an attempt to change what we are. And panic tries to, this path of unification, that's an attempt coming from panic. Shock doesn't attempt that. Shock is much wiser than panic. See, in shock, you're able to hear wisdom. Now, it still causes you suffering. It's like, I'm not familiar. But you block the panic, you go, wow. But I still say, okay, I have the wow, and I'm familiar with that. So I can hold on to the wow as I hear this wisdom, and I won't panic. So you're able to hear that. So shock is way, way wiser than panic. Panic tries to unify. To bring unity, meaning... Connect this moment with this moment, all these separate moments, connect the two. That's the attempt to, for panic, to have a new creation. And say, if once we have a new creation where everything's connected, then we will be happy. This is utterly absurd. It's the absurdity of panic. So don't ever try to understand the absurdity of panic. It's all absurd. It definitely, it thinks it's making progress connecting. There's nothing to connect. Okay, nothing's ever been born. There are no moments that are born, okay, into something. Everything is instantaneous in reality. It's not, there's no time for anything to be born. There's no time at all. Nothing is connected. Okay, it's all perfect. There's no connections needed. There's not, so you don't connect this moment with this moment and unite them, unify them. That's utter delusion. The delusion, but panic sees that as its path of salvation. So 100% minus of the world is on the path of panic, believing that panic has a way to find happiness through, you know, all these evolution, unification, all this stuff. There's a whole spirituality thing. Panic has its own spirituality. Panic has its own spirituality. And about 100% minus of the world is engaged in panic spirituality. Okay. What we're doing is shock spirituality, which is honoring our creativity, which is wow. It's just wow. We realize this has all been much ado about nothing. And we can't change what we are. But we realize the issue is honoring our creativity. That's the real issue now we have. And we don't just want to throw away the universe without, you know, a fond farewell, or without really coming to this graciousness, you know, a graciousness, okay, about it. We want a graciousness about it. We want to be gracious to ourselves, to our creativity. You know, what a madcap adventure, right? Pursuing this mystery of what's the mystery capability of this dream to change the dreamer. And we've been pursuing this mystery, and we'll, you know, and panic will keep pursuing it. All for naught. So we have shock spirituality, where 100% minus of the world has panic spirituality. And there's a lot of panic spirituality around, and during the 7-year period there'll be massive panic spirituality around, massive. And they can use any formulation they want, right, and make it, dress it up real nice, but it's still the same old thing. It's still the same old game, isn't it? Trying to simply develop, you know, ultimate perfect chronicness, so that now panic becomes normal. Fear becomes normal, right? So shock spirituality is quite different. It's quite different. It's just wow. It just works on familiarity. Accept your suffering, work on familiarity with truth. Accept your suffering, just get familiar with truth. Block the panic. Do not go back into panic spirituality. There's nothing you need to get except familiarity. There's nothing you need to do except familiarity. Nothing's ever happened except wow. Okay? Wow is all that's ever happened. Wow is all that's ever been born. And it's an indefinite definition. Undefined definition. Indefinite definition. It's an indefinite definition. It's just an indefinite definition, which is a bridge. Which is a bridge. It's a technique. It's a technique. Shock is able to use this technique. Understand, it's just a technique. It's not a reality. It's a technique. But that's okay, since nothing's ever happened, you see. There's nothing we need to undo, right? We just need to get reshape our expectations is all. So, using this technique is okay. It doesn't change reality either. To say that our creativity has reached the mystery is an undefined definition. That's the mystery. So at least for a while, we feel like we have succeeded in discovering the mystery. How do we change it? We succeeded, but it's an undefined definition. Okay, it's an undefinable definition. An undefinable definition, yes. And this sort of is a gracious way to let ourselves off the hook. It's a little white lie, as you might say. We know we can't define what we are, but we've tried to such an extent that we want to give ourselves a little pat on the back, like we it's the undefinable definition. Okay, that's what we are in time space, in the dream of definition. We're an undefinable definition. Okay. So that's what my creativity was up to. Okay. And so we give this little boost to ourselves. That's all. Now, panic won't do this, because panic, it feels so desperate. It says, no, I got to be happy. I got to get rid of all definition. You know, I got to jump. And in doing that, it overlooks expectations, overlooks familiarity, and overlooks honoring our creativity. It overlooks those three entirely and tries to leap into normality with the result of the backlash of falling back into panic and then thinking that the only way then is to induce happiness, which then leads to the sex, drugs, rock and roll, mania, okay? The manic phase of it all. Many will go into a manic phase going forward, okay? Very much so. I had to go somewhere yesterday to a shopping center, shopping area, real trendy shopping place. I never go there, but we had to return something and exchange. It was the wrong size. And so I got dragged along there. I said, no, I don't want to go. I went there, and it was a real eye-opener. It was so frantic. It was so frantic. I just observed, just calmly sitting there observing, you know, what's the pace? What's the push here? Is it shock or panic that's ruling the day here? You know, are these people in a state of panic, or are they in a state of shock? I'm in a state of shock. I realize I'm in a state of shock. I'm suffering in a state of shock. Okay. Now, what are they in? Are they in this state of shock or not? So 100% minus of us are either in a state of shock or state of panic. And most are in a state of panic. Everyone there was in a state of panic. Almost everyone. Actually, I was trying to make a right-hand turn, and the amount of pedestrians was constant stream, and I couldn't turn, and all the cars are waiting behind me. I said, man, I'm never going to get a turn because the pedestrians, so many people walking, and I had to wait. Finally, this guy stopped. He saw that there was no one coming in one direction. He was coming from another direction. He stopped, and I made eye contact with him, and he made eye contact with me, and I gave him a thumbs up, and he nodded and said, yeah. Because he saw what was going on. So that was someone who was in a state of shock. Okay, and I noticed the calmness of him. He was an Indian man, I think. And he didn't have the push. He didn't have this frantic push that is panic right now. He said, you know what? I don't have to just keep moving. Everybody else was heedless of me. My situation. But he saw the situation. He saw the situation. He said, hey, this guy's going to wait forever if I don't just, I could just wait here for like 2 seconds. So he makes this turn. And what I two or 3 seconds. He says, not a problem. Go ahead. And then I noticed it. I said, so there was that connection. Here was somebody connecting with somebody else who was not in panic. And I had the presence of mind to eye contact and thank him and nod and let him know I see your state of mind, you know. Whereas most people, they'd frantically turn, like, oh, I have a break here. They wouldn't even put two and two together. Oh, somebody let me, someone in a state of shock allowed me in. They don't even get that. They don't even get that here anymore. So what religion does is it really helps you accept a state of panic and accept a life of suffering. It really, the way of the cross, for instance, is accept that you're going to live a life of suffering. That's it. But this puts you into a state of shock, so you're able then to allow these glimpses of reality to take place, and more and more and more and more and more, and you get more and more familiar. This is all that it does. This is all that religion does. It's putting yourself in a state of shock. But we've lost that now. We've lost it. In like in the Silicon Valley, I've been able to chronicle the whole thing by how people drive, how people, the body language, everything. It used to be people would let you in no push, no problem. Now, the push is insane. The push is absolutely insane here. And the people were so frantic at that shopping area, so pushed. They're all caffeinated. They're all on something. And move, push. I'm just like, wow. Very shocking. Very shocking. So I didn't get caught up in the push. When we were trying to leave the parking garage, my God, people were frantic. So frantic. I had to back out, and kind of the car was waiting for me. I had to go get in the left lane so we could pull into my parking space, and then someone was trying to pull in where I was, and they wouldn't wait for me, and then they're going around. People, they can't stop. They're trying to induce happiness. That's where all the drugs, all the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, meaning all the weirdness, it's all an attempt to induce happiness. This is the great mistake. The great mistake. So it's a mistake that if just take it on faith. If you can't quite understand it, it's the worst thing you can possibly do. And don't try to neither crucify yourself nor try to induce happiness. Neither one. Just accept your baseline is going to be suffering. Now, it can be mild suffering, but don't try to fix that mild suffering. Just let it be there. And whatever results you get, you're going back to that, you see. You're going back to whatever glimpses of unbornness you have, you're going back to that. And don't try to reach some sort of ecstasy or some sort of happiness or as a contrivance. That's not a frame of reference shift at all. It's an attempt from panic to induce happiness, bliss, ecstasy, all this kind of stuff. This is the great mistake of this present age. The mortal mistake, the mistake that eventuates in believing that you need a lot more familiarity with panic in order to make chronic panic normal, the new normality. And so it you then kick the can down the road of your practice, and it becomes more and more lives, and your perspective is that you need that. You need to stay with panic. And of course, reality will panic you. Reality will panic you. That's the thing. We imagine that reality panics us. to stay away from it, to try and change it. But reality doesn't panic us at all. And paradoxically, the more chronically familiar we are with panic, the more that when we get a glimpse of reality, the more we panic. You see, I say, my God, there's no, I can't get more panic from reality. I need to get more used to panic, and there's no cause of panic anywhere. Oh my gosh, that's horrible. Where shock will say, wow, how shocking, wow, how shocking. It's a different reaction. Wow. Meaning, how shocking! That's shocking. It's shockingly great and shockingly frightening at the same time, isn't it? Perfect peace, no panic, and you have no capacity to panic at all. I can't cause any panic at all. Wow. So, wow. You see, that's very shocking. And you'll get familiar. 7 years, you'll get familiar with the landscape gradually. And you'll start getting wiser and wiser and wiser. Still suffering. Frame of reference shift will happen ultimately. You may have a glimpse of it. You say, oh my gosh, it's that simple. Utter simplicity. There's nothing to panic about. It's so easy that you can't panic. It's not like you're saying, okay, I'm doing it, but it's so difficult, it's so confusing, I'm gonna panic. No, it's like that. It's so easy and simple. There's no way you can panic about it. You can't mess it up. You cannot mess it up. Wow. How shocking that you cannot mess reality up at all. Cannot mess it up at all. Can't miss it. How shocking that you can't miss it. Whereas panic, of course, we'll view that as is super threatening. Because panic believes, again, that chronic panic will turn into normality, the new normality, if we just wait and stay with it for eons and eons and eons, it will become the new normality. So it believes in becoming. Process. It believes in process. Whereas in reality, there's no process at all. There's no becoming, no process. And that's very shocking. Shocking. So don't try to induce it. Just allow the shock of hearing that. Like, wow. That's very shocking to hear that. Yeah. So blocking the panic is all important during this next 7 years. It's all important. Just do just that and be really good at it. And keep. And you'll have to work at it. You'll have to work at it. And when you do that, you will find you avoided the worst of it. And you didn't get swept away into what? Trying to make chronic panic the new normality. You didn't get, because how long is that going to take? That'll take forever, and still, we'll be nowhere. And when you reach forever, then you realize you need forever times forever. And then when you reach that, you need forever times forever to the forever power of forever. And when you reach that, you know, it goes on, it never ends. Okay, so you've avoided that trap. Avoided that trap. And all of the frantic efforts that panic makes to make this happen, to automate forever, to automate, say, wow, this is too long, but if we just make it all automated and artificial intelligence and robotic, and we'll be able to do it. We'll be able to hang in there until chronic becomes normal, the new normal. It never does. Okay, so you'll avoid all those frantic efforts. The smartphone, I say, I don't call it a smartphone, I call it the slow phone. It's too slow. It's not fast enough. Shock is the fast way. It's the only fast way there is. Panic is the endlessly slow way. It's a slow way that just continues on being the slow way forever. It's never fast enough. It's never fast enough. So the smartphone is really a slow phone. I don't have a smartphone because it's too slow. I'm in the bridge, the shock way, the shock mood. I've accepted a life of shock instead of a life of panic. So in the life of shock, you want to go fast. It's very fast. So you don't want to be slowed down by a slow phone. Smartphones are slow phones, meaning they're super distracting and trying to induce. Super distracting. It's what panic has devised to try and automate its slowness, its ineffectiveness, to automate its chronic abnormality. So they think it's a speed. No, they're actually slowing down. Technology actually slows us down. It's time to flip the script on technology. Technology is a massive effort to slam on the brakes and slow down in our spiritual familiarity. Okay, it's an attempt to go from a life of shock to a life of panic, and to camouflage what's going on by telling us that we're speeding up. No, what they're doing is they're speeding up, going back to panic. They're going back to panic really fast. Okay, so the speed is to go back into slowness. They're hurrying back into slowness. They're hurrying and scurrying back into slowness. Whereas we're saying, well, we don't need that. We're accepting the life of shock, life of suffering. That's okay. I've suffered for 61 years. So I can suffer a few more years. Suffer the life of shock. Suffer a life of shock. Why? Because I know it'll come to an end fairly soon. I know a frame of reference shift will happen fairly soon. Okay, I know that for sure. On the brink of it. I know I'm on the brink of it. So I can continue to live a life of suffering. No big deal, right? No big deal. Don't have to take drugs, medications, anything like that. I just suffer. I'm suffering right now. I did, too much exercise. Suffering from too much exercise. got caught up in the push a little bit. Got caught up in the push a little bit, right? You get caught up, especially living here in Silicon Valley. It's so easy to get caught up in the push, to get pulled back towards panic. Because virtually 100% minus here are living lives of panic by their, you know, franticness of technology. It's like, we need to hurry up or get back to the slow, the abysmal slowness of panic. Slowly getting more familiar with chronic panic, making chronic more chronic, more chronic, more chronic. And that's all you do with a life of panic. You just make panic more chronic. Never results in anything at all, except more chronicness, which then has to be, have to shift out of that into a life of shock. And it's that simple. It's that simple. So I'm suffering. I don't take anything for it. I just go back to my good habits, get back to the habits, stop pushing too much, work on balance, okay? If you want to know what to work on, I always forget, what's the most important thing? Balance. We don't want to induce crucifixion. Crucifixion, we don't want to induce happiness, okay? Just accept a sort of a blah feeling. Just feel kind of, just feel that, way. When we say I feel great, it means, well, I just feel in a state of shock, which is great. It's like way better than panic, right? It's not ultimacy, no, but it's great. We don't say I feel ultimate, or I feel silent, silence, isness, just silence, just silence. Unending eloquence. I say, I feel great, mean I'm having a life of shock, which is, you feel great with a life of shock. You feel you're doing something great, but you're still suffering. So we could say, well, I'm content to suffer. I'm not trying to get rid of suffering. I'm accepting it for now. I'm accepting it. It will disappear without a trace when the frame of reference shift takes place. All suffering will disappear without a trace, like it never was. Because actually it never was. It was all imaginary. It'll just automatically disappear. Frame of reference shift, automatically disappear. So we don't need to aim to get rid of suffering. Okay. We just need to aim for the frame of reference shift, which comes about through familiarity. With these little glimpses, 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 glimpses. And glimpses happen when we're willing to wow the result and stay in shock and block the panic. So these little glimpses will not, we'll be too afraid of them. If they cause us to go back into panic, we'll then block these glimpses. We don't want them. But if we can block going back into panic, then we're willing, okay, like I get up in the morning, I say, you know what? I think I can handle some insight today. I think I can handle some clarity today. I'm ready to block the panic. I'm ready to accept the shock of it. And then you know what? It happens. When I'm in that mood, that willingness, the insights come. Tremendous, tremendous breakthroughs. Tremendous. But then I go back into the shock. Say, wow, okay. My definition still is an undefined definition. I still view my identity as an undefinable definition. I still view my identity as an undefinable definition. And so we're just going to stick with that. My identity is wow, undefinable definition, and we express that as the label is wow. The label is wow. Now, you're hearing this and you're saying, wow, this is very, very clear, very reasonable. I can feel it. I recognize this. This is it. This is it. This is it. But then what? He said, wow. He said, wow. Shocking. Shocking. So if you accept a life of shock, it's repentance. Repentance, contrition. Contrition of heart means panic doesn't work. Okay. I can't turn chronic abnormality into the new normality. Impossible. So that'll never work. So I can't, and so that means I'm going to keep suffering for a while because I have this vast familiarity with that. Okay, I'll accept this. I'll accept suffering for a while. I will accept it. And I'll, but I'll work on familiarity, and that's very interesting. It's very compelling. It becomes a very, very interesting, worthwhile life to do this. Even though you're still suffering, your life becomes very compelling. Very compelling. Because you know you're headed to the promised land. You know it. Which is the frame of reference shift. We don't try to say what is there beyond the frame of reference shift. It's really cannot be, it's even beyond the definite, yet indefinite definition. The indefinite definition, it's even beyond the indefinite definition. But we're not going to identify with that. When it happens, it happens. Don't try to identify with that directly. It'll automatically be there. So what we're going to do is get used to glimpse that, but keep identifying with the indefinite definition. I am what? The indefinite definition. That's what I am. I am wow. I am wow. How do I feel? I feel wow. So it's a bridge identity. It's a bridge identity. It's a bridge identity. This is wisdom to do it this way. So wisdom is what we need. Wisdom is what we need right now. Wisdom is what we need as we go through this tribulation period. I call it between the two eclipses, the one in 217, the one that's just, you know, either about to take place or will have, depending when you watch this, and the one to come in 2024. You know, the world is interested in this. It's a media thing. It's an obsession. I mean, I know lots of people are going up to Oregon in that area here to watch it. And others have said, you know, I couldn't afford it. It's hotels are like $1,500 a night. By this time, they may be $2,000. Any place, $2,000 a night. And you need to stay probably. And the traffic, you need to get up there early because trying to drive in there, like from Northern California, it's going to be gridlock. Gridlock. I mean, it's a mania. Right here in California and in the United States. It's eclipse mania, actually. And of course, there's all these wildfires. I mean, the town where it's supposed to be the best place to watch it, where it first comes, it's right ashore there, you can see it. I think there's wildfires. I think it has to be like almost evacuated because the wildfires are so bad around there. This is very symbolic that the eclipse is going to cause this wildfire where panic tries to induce happiness. The great mistake. A great mistake, and it's such a great mistake. We have to take every measure to avoid it. And you know, it is scary to know that there's this great mistake is going to happen in the next 7 years, and many will go down that road, and we don't want to go down that road. So we do have to pray to the Holy Spirit, the grace of God. We pray, grace of God, protect us. Grace of God, protect us. I know I'll be protected. And I pray that everyone else accepts protection for themselves. And wow is the way. My identity is this. I have this identity, an undefinable definition, an indefinite definition. And that's final. That's final. That's my last conceptualization, is the indefinite definition. That's my final conceptualization. But I'm going to hold on to that. I'm going to hold on to that. If a frame of reference shift takes place, either for me or for you, then it takes place. There's nothing to say about it, okay? If that takes place. Can it take place? Sure, it's possible. It's possible. I've glimpsed it many times. I understand it could take place in my case. It could, or it could not, okay? But if it does, it does. But until it does, I'm going to hold on to this final conceptualization of identity. My identity is this indefinite definition, which we label as wow, just as wow. For the sake of some convention here. You see, convention can be very helpful during these next 7 years. So I don't want to preach no convention at all. That, if you want to be unconventional, you will be. But I'm not going to structure it in a completely unconventional way. I'm going to use, say that, you know, we're using wow. Okay, if you want to use something else, you're being unconventional. Okay, you're being unconventional. I can't answer to that. I cannot answer to that. That's got a lot of panic in it involved, okay? It's not a time to be unconventional. In terms of, if there's this new convention, this new way, okay? Just one unconventionality. You might say, well, that's unconventional. Well, we're accepting this one unconventionality of a new way. But within that, we're not trying to be unconventional. Okay, we're not trying to multiply unconventionality. We're going to be very strict in terms of our conventionality. And wow is how we label identity. I am wow. Wow, and wow is wow. Wow is wow. Wow as well. So, a lot of fires. It could be cloudy. Nobody even see the eclipse in Oregon. And people are spending, there's some 80-year-old lady I know here. She just drove all the way up to Oregon to watch it. I mean, it's like super important to the panic-based people. Okay, it's super important. They're looking for a new age. They're trying to find a way to induce happiness. Okay. It's the whole spirituality of panic is involved, wrapped up in this eclipse, and you know the new age and all this stuff. You know they want something to trigger something. Oh, there's nothing to be triggered except a frame of reference shift, ultimately, which only comes through this bridge of accepting a life of shock. Okay, that'll just happen when we're familiar enough, so that it will not panic us. We'll just say when we're ready. That's it. So we're not in this push. I'm not driving up to Oregon. You know, I'm not pushing to see the eclipse. I'm not any push at all there. I'm not even interested in it. I do, though, understand it's going to trigger the world into this attempt to induce happiness, which is the great mistake. That's why it's a tribulation period now, is people are frantic. They have different ideas of how to induce happiness. Since nothing works, how can you not have different ideas, right? How can you not have, they're trying to unite somehow, right? Everyone's trying to unite. That's the big mistake. So there'll be all these attempts to unite, and it's happening right now. And that ultimately, since it doesn't work, you have to somehow account for the fact that it doesn't work. So you have to blame someone else. You have to scapegoat. So the whole attempt to unite carries with it. The flip side of that is scapegoating, which then produces conflict and war, civil war, all the troubles. So this is when we abandon a life of shock, which the world has, you go into war, severe psychological conflicts, which is what's happening in the United States. It's happening, around the world, because the world decided to go back into panic, abandon a life of shock, lost its nerve. But we haven't lost our nerve, okay? Most have. I haven't. Have had to work at it for, now this is my 50th year of working at it very consciously, just to not lose my nerve. And have to keep working at it and get protection and help. Absolutely. Even though you've been working on it, you still need protection and help. Somehow in your life, grace of God will provide that for you. Just ask for it. Say, God, I've accepted a life of shock, and therefore I accept your protection of this lifestyle that I have. I accept your protection, that you will protect this lifestyle, because I've accepted a life of shock. I've accepted this final conceptualization of all my creativity, which is this indefinite definition. Okay, I've accepted this indefinite definition, and I will hold on to that until the frame of reference shift occurs. Whenever it occurs, I don't know when it will occur. I'm not trying to pinpoint when it will occur. It will just happen when I'm ready for it to happen. That's all. And until then, I'm holding on to this indefinite definition. Wow. Very simple, right? Very simple. And I have to tell you that the weather in the Bay Area has been the weirdest weather I can ever remember in August. It is totally weird. Okay. Totally weird. Living here for 61 years, I don't know if I said 60 before, 61 now. I got to remember, got to keep up with it. That It's never been like this, really, in August. This is the weirdest weather ever in August. I call it eclipse weather. I mean, it is just feels really weird. I say, what is going on? What in the world is this? You can hardly see. It's the atmosphere is so polluted in some way. There's a lack of clarity. Like I'm driving, I can hardly see. Yesterday I was driving, I can hardly see up ahead of me. The glare, the strange atmosphere. It's such a strange atmosphere here. I don't like it at all. August is my month, and I said, what did you do to my August? You ruined it. Not happy about that. Not at all. I usually luxuriate in August weather. Just my favorite weather, and this has just been horrible. Horribly weird. Putting on jackets, you know, in the morning, it's just bizarre. And right, it fits in perfectly with what's coming, the weirdness of it, the lack of clarity that's coming, and dangerous. So to say, God, I've accepted a life of shock, the life of shock, and so I accept your absolute protection of this life of shock, and nothing can get in the way of this life of shock. I'm committed to it. I'm committed to the indefinite definition. I'm committed to wow, the way of wow, the life of wow. I'm committed to the life of wow. So people, yeah, well. We don't need to chronicle what's taking place. I mean, panic, why chronicle panic? It's chronicling nothing at all. It's chronicling futility, sad, deplorable futility, ways to induce happiness, meaning ways to make chronic abnormality normal, are just silly. You know, there's no point to chronicling it. It has no relevance to anything at all. It's just creativity, but we've accepted the ultimate creativity is the indefinite definition, and so that's it. We've accepted how all that, the ultimacy of this. We've already accepted the ultimacy of it, so we don't need to chronicle anything at all. The squirrels are getting ready. They're squirreling away everything they can right now. So we try and stay away from the news. There's nothing we need to chronicle. We already have how it all ends. We have the total chronicle already. It's already been chronicled. The Holy Spirit chronicled it all. All attempts to make abnormality normal. The Holy Spirit has already chronicled all of it. And it tells us it all ends at all. The total sum total of it is, wow, is the indefinite definition. The indefinite definition, which is wow. That is the chronicling of it. So we've already chronicled it. It's already been chronicled for us. And this enables us to live a life of shock. Wonderful, huh? The wonderful life of shock. The wonderful life of shock. It's the best you can do with life at all. It's the very best that can be done. And that it leads us to liberation from life. There's nothing better than to not have a life. That's the ultimate. No life at all. That's called freedom. That's called reality. Freedom doesn't have a life. There are no lives in reality. There's just this flow through us, which is the freedom. We allow this freely flowing creativity flow through us, and it's just constant flow of freedom. There's no life. There's no limit. We say, well, now this is a limitation, a boundary, and a definition. No, we allow the flow of God, the creativity of God, to flow through us continuously in any which way we want, and that's called freedom. There's not a life being lived. There's just freedom flowing, the flow of creativity, the free flow of creativity eternally. But again, That's automatically is when the frame of reference shift takes place. You can never conceptualize this at all. So we say the ultimate conceptualization is not freedom or truth or love or any peace. The ultimate conceptualization is the indefinite definition of wow. That's the ultimate, that's higher than love, peace, all this conceptualization. It's the highest spirituality there is. Wow is the highest spirituality there is. Beyond that, nothing more can be said. Beyond that, there's only silence in terms of definition and concept. It's the highest spirituality is wow, the indefinite definition, the sum total of all attempts, okay? All foolishness, all misadventurousness, all attempts to change what we are, is the sum total. It's the highest concept, the indefinite definition. And I am wow. That's the highest spirituality, and we can just stick with that. We don't need to go down to any lower spirituality. Even peace and love and oneness and all these other concepts, leave them alone. Leave them alone. Even freedom, leave it alone. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. Leave all those other concepts alone. Because that is a slippery slope, a very slippery slope. Because then we're saying, well, we don't have the sum total of it yet. How do we get this? You know, but we rest in that we have the sum total. We have the complete summation of it all. It's the indefinite definition of wow. Keep in mind, our whole purpose for this universe is to define what we are, to define reality. So we have arrived at that purpose. We have fulfilled the purpose, and that, so that's the highest concept. The highest concept is wow. There, beyond that, there is no concept at all. No concept at all. So yet we're still suffering. Even though we have this, of course, with your concept, you'll still suffer. But it's the highest concept. But don't play with concepts. This is an attempt to induce normalcy onto chronic abnormality. Okay, so don't play with concepts like love and peace and try to, you know, just say the play is over. I have it. The play is over. I have it. I have the highest concept, which means I'm honoring my creativity. Honoring my creativity. And we honor our creativity by the highest, right? The highest concept. That's how we honor our creativity. And that's wow. Pragmatically, it's wow. I mean, block the shock of indefinite definition is what is wow. How do I feel about that? Wow. Wow is wow. So wow is blocking the shock, blocking the panic. It blocks the panic, keeps us in shock. And then the shock, we get used to it, and the edge wears off. It's like we go from a sharp knife of shock to a butter knife of shock. We're still suffering, but the intensity wears off. When we have a breakthrough, it feels like, oh, this is really sharp. You know, this is really intense. Gradually, intensity dissipates. Now you say, oh, it's just a butter knife. You know, it's dull. It's just a dull shock now. It's not a sharp shock. It's a dull shock. So we go between, we don't oscillate, but we're not trying to oscillate to induce anything. Keep in mind that oscillating between truth and lies is not a third condition. It's not a third condition. It's just oscillation. Okay, just like chronic abnormality is not normal. Oscillation is not a third option at all. We panic thinks to oscillate is the answer. Maybe that's the mystery. There's some mysterious power in oscillation that will produce some third, you know, option that is neither normal nor abnormal, but it's the new normality. The new normality, which chronic turns into normality. Normal. Chronic turns into normal. They think that's the third. There's no such option. It's just oscillating, which gets very tiresome. So we try not to oscillate. We just say wow is wow. We block the oscillation by saying wow is wow. Wow is wow. You see, get that? Wow is wow. Wow is wow. Where's the oscillation there? Very minimal kind of feel to it. It's just, it keeps us in shock instead of panic. Wow is wow. cap our expectations. It keeps us in shock. We want to stay in shock and not go back to panic. Those are those really pragmatically, those are the two options we have within delusion. Is it either, it's either shock or panic. That's still the option of delusion, right? But within that, we temporarily, we can choose shock instead of panic. That doesn't, that's not a third option that negates truth and lies both, okay? Shock doesn't negate truth. We realize we have no choice but to choose truth. We have no choice but to choose. It's either truth or lies. We have no choice, but we can choose pragmatically this bridge to it. We can choose a bridge to it. A bridge is not a reality, okay? It's not a reality. It's still an illusion. Still an illusion. But it's the illusion that frees us from all other illusions. So, it's easy for me to talk this way because I've worked at it so much. But for the listener, I'm sure it's like, whoa, I mean, I can't quite follow. Wow, but you can follow, just say, accept the life of shock, right? Be contrite of heart and say, okay, I will suffer. I'm not trying to get rid of all suffering. I am not trying to get rid of all suffering. I want to honor my creativity in imagining suffering. So much suffering we've imagined, haven't we? To try and change what we are. So much suffering we've imagined. A universe full of suffering we've imagined. In so many different ways, haven't we, imagined suffering. I have to honor this. I really want to honor it. So honor it with the highest concept of all, which is the indefinite definition of wow. I am wow. I am wow. And to block the panic, oscillation is wow is wow. Because panic will try to oscillate, to pull you down into panic. Oscillation is often the way panic uses that to pull you back down into panic. So to block panic, we say wow is wow. Whatever arises, that's wow, and wow is wow. Truth is wow. Lies are wow. Emptiness is wow. Fullness is wow. Nothingness is wow. Thingness is wow. This is wow. This and wow is wow. Wow is wow. Wow is wow. We're so used to using oscillation, thinking that this will provide the mystery. This is the answer. That if we don't use this wow is wow formulation, wow is wow, wow is wow, it's very easy to get pulled back by oscillation. So we use this sort of indefinite oscillation. What do you call it? Non-oscillating oscillation. A non-oscillating oscillation. Wow is wow. Wow is wow. It feels familiar to us. Yeah, I feel like I'm oscillating, except mentally we're not oscillating. The form of oscillation is there, but the confusion of oscillation isn't there. Okay, so we still say wow, yeah, wow is wow, wow is wow is wow is wow is wow is wow, wow is wow, wow is wow, wow is wow, wow is wow. But the miracle is, we stay with shock. We don't go into panic. What a miracle! And we still feel somewhat, you know, we feel butter knife dull in the shock, but we still feel like close to truth. We still feel like available to truth instead of the blindness of panic. Desperately then seeking, running after some way to induce happiness. All those people at this big shopping center, trendy, very trendy place, boy, were they frantically chasing after happiness. Frantically, all of them. Everyone dressed in fashion, you know, so fashionable. And you could tell they're trying to induce happiness. They're looking to induce happiness. Hi, I'm your ticket to induce, I can help you induce happiness. Oh, I want to induce happiness too. Oh, we have a relationship based on inducing happiness. Wonderful. You know, well, that'll really kick the can down the road. And we can stay with panic even longer now. And hopefully the chronic abnormality will turn into the new normality. Yeah, let's make it happen. Let's help this unification. Let's help this all be one. You know, let's all unify. And we can connect finally. We can all be connected. All these different lives can now be connected. And this is the new reality. Oh, this would be wonderful. The new normality. Now, reality, there's only the one. There's only the one. We don't even say it's a life. We cannot even say it's a life. Because that brings up the idea of a not life kind of to us. We're so used to it. It just is. It's just the flow of creativity through us, through spirit, in perfect freedom. Seamless flow. Seamless flow. Occasionally you might experience this. Don't try to induce it, though. Sometimes it'll just happen. It just happens through familiarity, through the work we do here. It will happen occasionally, and it's just the creativity is 360 degree. Anything you see, you're never stuck. Your creativity flows through that also. So there's always this flowing through of creativity, no matter what we seem to be perceiving or experiencing. That too, you flow through that as well. The creativity flows through it. Creativity flows through it. And so it's just this beautiful flow of creativity with nothing being stuck anywhere. And it's just like, wow. You experience that and you just say, I love that. You know, wow. But your definition of that is indefinite definition. Your identity, your sense of identity is still indefinite definition. The indefinite definition. That's what I am. I'm still a concept. You're not trying to destroy that concept. It will vanish without a trace once the frame of reference takes place. It will vanish without a trace into thin air like it never was. Gracefully. With utter grace. It will vanish with utter grace. Total grace. Okay. So we're not trying to make it vanish. It will spontaneously vanish with total grace. Without a trace. Into thin air. And we'll feel good about it. We'll say, ah, it's perfect. That's just perfect. Okay, that will just happen automatically with a frame of reference. We don't try to make it, induce that by trying to destroy this concept of indefinite definition. Wow. We don't try to modify the wow. Okay. We don't try to, it's the one thing we don't try to modify. And since we're not trying to induce happiness, we're not trying to modify anything. We just say, I've got what I want, which is wow. I don't want to modify it. I'm happy with it. I'm content enough with it. I'm content enough with it. I'm not happy with it. I'm content. I'm still suffering, but I'm content with it. There's a contentment and acceptance of it. I'm not trying to modify it. I accept it. I know once I really get used to familiar with accepting this, then a frame of reference shift will take place and it will again gracefully dissolve as if it never was, and I will feel perfectly okay with that. Okay, that's how it happens. That's what takes place. This is what I've seen. So we're not trying to modify the wow. That's why we say wow is wow. Wow is wow. But we're so used to trying to modify that we intentionally practice this pseudo-modification. Wow is wow. Like I'm trying to apply something to wow. Okay, but I apply what? I apply wow to wow. And modification of wow is what? Is wow. The oscillation of wow is wow. Wow is the oscillation, the modification. It's wow. The thinking is wow. The planning is wow. The inducement is wow. Wow induces wow. Wow induces wow. So I have the inducement, the oscillation, the modifications. Wow is wow. Wow is wow. It accounts for all of those old habits. We don't try to kill off the old habits. We account for them. This is wisdom. We account for them in our practicing. to try and induce happiness is try to kill off our expectations, our habits, our familiarity, to try and kill it off. And then this produces massive troubles for us. It's really the ego's way, again, it's the way of panic. The path that panic believes in really induces massive delay, which is its whole goal in the first place, is to make the chronic even more chronic, which means what? A massive amount of delay in panic. That's what exactly what it means. So panic knows how to induce more panic through its own type of spirituality. Trying to do too much, to leap, to kill off habits, to kill it off. That's a, you know, drastic mistake. And so, but yet we have to account for our habits. We can't kill them off, so we still have this habit of oscillation. So we'll oscillate between wow and wow, right? And we still have this habit of trying to modify. So we'll modify wow with wow. And the result of that modification is wow. Wow is wow. This accounts for our habits. Wow is wow. So we have this, I am wow, and wow is wow. I mean, I am the indefinite definition, and the oscillation, modification, strategy, planning, thinking, reaction, feel of wow is wow. Wow is wow. And that, what does this do? Keeps us in shock. Keeps us in a state of shock. Keeps us in a life of shock. Mental state of shock instead of the mental state of panic. And therefore, we are available to reality. Available to it. We make ourselves available to reality when we're able to keep ourselves stable in the shock. Stay in the shock. Block the panic. We're available to reality. And then we can get glimpses. I've had so many glimpses. So many, 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 many glimpses. And yet I'm still suffering. Still in shock, sure. And I overdid it working out. I was in such great shape. I said, let me push it. And I, you know, pushed it too much because of this, you know, this frantic push that the world is in right now. It's affecting us, isn't it? I mean, absolutely it is. It's insane, isn't it? It's panic. It's panic trying to induce happiness. It's panic trying to make itself the new normal. The new normal. And in order to do that, it has to become more chronic. And we're so dissatisfied with this that panic has to try and promise happiness. So panic is always promising happiness and saying you can get it easily. Here, look, here's this drug. That'll give you happiness. What it really means is just hang in there a little longer with panic, and it'll eventually, this chronic abnormality will become the new normality. So just so you get this sort of pseudo happiness, right? Sex, drugs, and rock and roll that just give this little hit of thrill, cheap thrills, and it says, you know, it keeps you delaying. You say, oh, I can delay a little longer. I can delay a little longer. I'm hanging in there. Medicating myself with these cheap thrills, I can wait a little longer. That's panic. That's what panic does. It's always promising happiness, the cheap happiness, for the sake of delay. That's how we delay. The spirituality of panic is all about delay. It's all about delay. It lacks wisdom. The rhetoric can be, you know, off the charts, great rhetoric. Okay. But the purpose of it all is delay. Here, our rhetoric can be actually very simple. Just wow. Just wow. Okay? Shock doesn't really need all that high rhetoric, actually. It doesn't need it. It has what it already has what it needs, which is wow. That's it. Doesn't need anything else. Now we can use that rhetoric if we see some use for it. I don't have any problem, I can do it. But we gotta be careful that we don't get caught up in that rhetoric too much. We already have what we need. We don't need to induce happiness. We already have the sum total of all attempts to induce happiness. We already have the definition, which is an indefinite definition. We already have it. So it's just a matter of holding on to it and staying in the life of shock so I can get familiar with truth. Very simple. Where do we need all the rhetoric? Do we really need all that spiritual rhetoric, actually? But Panic has to use the rhetoric. We can either use it or not use it. See, I'm fine either way. Sometimes use a little bit of it, but I'm fine just wow. Just wow. Okay? Just wow. Wow is wow. But panic can't do this. It has to promise happiness in order to delay more, because we're so unhappy with panic. We're so miserable. It has to keep promising, you know, quick results, like, oh yeah, here's happiness. You get it this way. Get it this way. Here's a panic relationship. That, you know, that'll give cheap thrills. That'll give you some happiness. And meanwhile, we're almost there. We're almost, chronic abnormality is almost now the new normal. Almost. Just about there. And delay. You never get around to a life of shock, which gets familiar with truth. You never get around to it. So you stay familiar with panic and all this spiritual rhetoric, which doesn't do you any good at all, ultimately. Okay? Doesn't really do you any good at all, ultimately. It's the direct experiencing that does you good. Not through the filter of any rhetoric at all, actually. It's the direct experiencing that the glimpses that help familiarity move forward, help familiarity develop. It's not the intellectual rhetoric. You listen to someone, you know, from this school and this school and this school and this school. I was reading an article, a discussion, and they had all these teachers from all these different traditions, and they were all trying to explain emptiness. You know, and it's just like, you know, that's not what we do. That's panic. That's a panic approach. I'm not saying the teachers were in that, but the purpose of the article was to try, you know, give you what is emptiness, you know, and it devolves into rhetoric. I mean, the teachers are kind of say, well, it's not about rhetoric, you know. So I mean, you know, but why even go through that exercise? Actually, it's a dangerous exercise. Very dangerous. Because it's going down the road towards rhetoric by saying no rhetoric, but still, you know, entertaining that notion. It's panic-based. The wise teacher would just say, wow, what is emptiness? Wow. Are you saying that emptiness is wow? I'm saying wow is wow. But what is emptiness? Emptiness is wow. Or you can say, I'm not going to emptiness yet. You know, so it's a moot point. It's a moot point. The question of what is emptiness is really a panic-based approach. It's a completely creed irrelevancy, because we never reach emptiness. There's no one reaching emptiness. So how can we say there's emptiness? We cannot say anything at all about reality. We cannot say anything at all. So it's stupid to try and use spiritual rhetoric around it, really. That's panic approach. We say we already have what we need conceptually. We don't need to play with concepts. We don't need to play with concepts. We have the indefinite definition, which is the highest concept. From that point, there's no more need to play with concepts. We see the folly of that, and we see the wisdom of not playing with concepts, and yet we're not yet ready to get rid of concepts. See, when you play with concepts, it's trying to induce no concept. It's an inducement technique. We don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. Frame of reference shift will automatically happen once we're familiar, have enough glimpses of truth, and we do that by blocking panic, staying in shock, and you will have, every single day, I have many, many breakthroughs, every single day, okay, many glimpses, sometimes I get in a groove, and it's just, wow, one after another, and I just say, wow, 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 wow. And at the end of the day, I'm still suffering, and I say that's fine. That's fine. At the end of the day, I'm still suffering, and that's fine. So, and tomorrow also I'll be suffering too. And if I and as long as there's an I will be suffering. That's fine. As long as there's any belief that there's any even potential for birth, any even the tiniest potential, I'll still be suffering. They'll still be suffering. My experience will be suffering. My pretense will be suffering. Of course. Of course. And I'll see a universe of suffering. Of course. There's no two ways about it. No two ways about it. But that scares people. They say, well, that means you need ultimacy. Yeah, but a frame of reference shift just... the pretense is gone, that's all. And there's just a flow through us, through everything. Again, whatever we're experiencing, we think, oh, is that something? But we're able then to flow through that too. There's nothing that our creativity cannot flow through. There's nothing our creativity cannot flow through. There's no such situation of a life that our creativity cannot flow through into anything at all. So how can we call anything a life? It's absurd, isn't it? Our creativity can flow through anything that arises through our creativity. Our creativity can flow through that in any which way at all. And that's always the case. That's always the case. So how can we, how preposterous it is to claim that there's some life somewhere, right? There's only just this one flow of creativity. We can flow through an entire universe instantly, right? And it can become anything at all, or nothing at all, so to speak. I mean, whatever. It can flow. We can flow through it in any which way, in any which way. This instant, and every instant, we can flow through an entire universe. We can flow through infinite universes this instant, in any which way we want to, creatively. We can flow through the entire universe just as a dewdrop if we want to. And then we can flow through that dewdrop as a universe if we want to. Right? And it never ends. It never ends. It never ends. And we say, well, how is that relevant to a life? Well, how is a life relevant to that? It's not. There's no relevancy. There's no relevancy. Life is an attempt to change this infinite flow that can flow through anything at all. There's no barriers to the flow of creativity. There are no barriers. We can imagine a star, and our creativity can flow through that star, and the star, the flow of creativity now is a lake. Okay. It's just a lake. And we can flow through that lake, and that lake can become a world. We can flow through that world, and that world can become a star. And we can flow through the star, and, you know, it. No limit to our creativity. No limit to our creativity. So if this arises, if you experience this, just let the experience take place. And wow, but I'm still a concept. I'm still a concept. When the frame of reference shift takes place, it will be this sort of just this ultimate. It will just be, you realize the flow again. I mean, it's just, and there's no attempt to limit it, so to speak, limit it. And our flow of creativity can be one of anything at all. Right? It can be a flow of not flowing, but that too, we can instantly flow through that not flowing also, right? It can be nirvana, not flowing. Okay, we think we've found the answer in nirvana? No. We think we found the answer in samsara? No. Where nirvana is just the no flowing, whereas this world tends to be flowing but hitting barriers. We think there's a flow still taking place, but I can't flow through this right now. You know, maybe later I can, but I have to now flow around it like a stream has to flow around the boulders, right? So it's an obstructed flow, but that's not reality. So we try to avoid this feeling of obstructedness by saying, well, no flow at all, which is like nirvana. No flow at all. But we can flow through nirvana instantly. All creativity. And nirvana can be now Our flow of creativity is now is flowing through, flowed through that, and now it's something different. Now it's perfect flow. So nirvana and samsara are the same, two sides of the same coin of trying to change reality. Nirvana is an attempt to be happy, to find, induce happiness. I got to find some happiness. This obstructed flow is not making me happy, so let me just get rid of flow altogether. Yeah, flow of creativity altogether. It's like a trance state. Yeah. But still doesn't make us happy. Temporarily might say, oh, you know, this is nice. But God created us to flow, to be creative, and that feeling is still there. Like, I don't quite feel like I'm normal yet. This isn't quite normal. Still not normal. Nirvana is still not normal. Samsara and nirvana, neither one are normal. Two sides of abnormality. Two sides of abnormality. Wow. But I have the final concept that I want, which is, wow, the indefinite definition. The indefinite definition. Wow. I have it. So, I have some, you know, mild suffering, and along with that, but I don't, in oscillation and wow as wow, so when I get something unexpected, like truth, wow, old habits jump up, okay, oscillation, wow as wow, there you go, definition, wow as wow. Modification, wow is wow. Inducement, wow, wow induces wow. Wow induces wow. Happiness is wow. Everything is wow. So you remain stable and steady, no panic. And just let the sharp edge of shock wear off so it becomes duller. And then again, you can then again more familiarity. Very simple. Very simple. This is just a basic. This is the basics that historically have been done in one way or the other. Gets a little muddled. I mean, if you have someone's really clear about it, others are not so clear about it, and so as time goes on, it gets muddled. A little, you know, it gets muddled, sure. But now we just have to refocus our clarity on this, get real sharp, clear, very clear about it, so we can use this the next 7 years, and, you know, it'll get muddled again. It gets muddled, and then has to be reintroduced in a real clear way, and it gets muddled again. People try to teach you that they don't have it clear enough in their mind, they don't see it clearly enough, they're not familiar enough with it. They try to teach it, they think, oh, okay, I got it conceptually, I'm going to teach, and then it becomes muddled, and gradually, you know, it all gets muddled. It doesn't matter who brings this into the world, it's going to get muddled. What, who has brought anything into this world that it doesn't get muddled? The teachers say that. They say, I told you this, and you just twisted it around and muddled it, you know. What can I do? You want a teaching that doesn't get muddled? How is that possible here? How is that possible? Of course it gets muddled. But we can keep it pretty clear for a while, right? And that's what's important right now. The next 7 years, let's just work on keeping it really clear. Let's just keep working on it. It's so simple, isn't it, really? Just keep it simple and be willing to be simple like that. The world's going to get very complex as people will try massive attempts at inducing happiness of all types. I talked to a friend 2 days ago. He said, hey, in where I live, there's a massive heroin epidemic. I said, what? I know where he lives. He said, what? He said, yeah. My friends, people I know, they're smoking it, they're injecting it, they're doing everything with heroin. They're dying, they're white, they're going into terrible troubles. He says it's just a blazing epidemic of heroin. This is taking place all over the world. Heroin is in making an enormous comeback because this sign of the times is an attempt to induce happiness, heroin. One of the stronger attempts. I mean, methamphetamine is also another way, and it's raging. Cocaine is another way. These ecstasy, the other drugs, all the different drugs are attempting for panic to induce happiness, and it's epidemic levels, epidemic. I mean, the Bay Area, there's a whole bunch of places in the greater Bay Area which have epidemics right now of severe drug usage, whether it's methamphetamine, heroin, cocaine, the whole combination of it all, really. Massive pot usage everywhere, also attempt to induce happiness. There are areas, a lot of areas in the Bay Area where it's you could say it's epidemic right now. It's that way all over. I talked to people, Central California told me that it's out of control all up and down the whole state. The heroin, methamphetamine, you know, the drug problems are just hideous, 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 hideous. I live in a little pocket here where it's not taking place because everyone here, they're chasing $1 billion and they're very serious and they're very disciplined. And they don't mess around with that stuff because they want to make they're attempting to induce happiness through by becoming billionaires. So I don't experience the drug scene around here at all, not at all, not at all. I know someone up the street suicided on it a while ago, and someone else. You know, you hear that young people are dying from it for sure. Because of the pressure that they're under, young people are under such pressure to induce happiness because the whole culture of shock, of a shock life, a life of contrition, a life of repentance, that is collapsed so badly that young people are rootless. They think that I have to induce happiness. I panic is my life and I have to induce happiness, which means I have to delay. I have to find a way to delay. They don't have any hope. The only hope is to turn chronic abnormality into normality, so they have to delay, and then they figure, I got to use drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll. Somehow I got to delay, because I don't have any hope otherwise. But a culture, a shock-based culture, has genuine hope that in the frame of reference shift. They know it will take place. They know it takes place. They have those who are utterly free, okay, of delay, totally free of absurdity. Totally free of the notion of lives, okay? The great ones that have come into the world, they know that this is possible, and they're told this. You can do it too. If you do the right way, it will take place. Also, the frame of reference shift will take place for you. They assure us this is so, and it does take place when you follow that way, that culture. It does take place more than we realize. More than we realize. The young people today don't have that, so the drugs, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Well, what else can they turn to, really? Money, you know, super, super success. But problem is that only the very ruthless and disciplined can be really successful, like, you know, be billionaires. And most of us realize you can't compete. You can't compete with that. It's just, there's some that are just geared that way, and we know the moguls, the titans, you know, the big wigs, they're geared that way because that's their such an exclusive focus, that just like some are geared towards drugs, for instance, some are geared towards being billionaires. And of course they reach that, and it's never enough. It's never enough. But when people realize, I'm not going to be able to be a billionaire, then they turn to drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll. They say, wow, I've got to induce happiness in some way. You know, mutilation, sadomasochism, all this kind of stuff. It's just, you know, pain. You know, that pain is pleasurable. It's inducing something different, you know. And again, it's all for the service of delay. All panic-based spirituality is all for the purpose of delay. It may sound great rhetorically, but it's for the purpose of delay. So waiting until hoping that chronic abnormality will finally become so chronic it becomes normal. And therefore we know that normality is happiness. We think, miracle, you know, magic. It's now all happy. and of course, this abnormality will always be abnormality. Normality is normal without a second. You know, there's nothing besides the normal. Okay, normality is that our creativity can flow through everything. It's completely unobstructed, free and unobstructed, eternally so. That's normality, and there's no obstruction. You know that we have to flow around. Okay, there's no obstruction. This whole dream of having to flow around obstructions, that whole dream can be flowed. Our creativity can flow through that entire dream, like the whole universe, just in an instant, like that. And when it does, we just say, oh, I'm back to normality. Frame of reference shift. Okay, ultimately, that's what has to happen, is we realize I can flow through both samsara and nirvana simultaneously in the whole universe. I can flow through everything simultaneously. Instantly and simultaneously. There's no obstruction to creativity. And that is God. No obstruction to creativity. We can even flow through God, so to speak. Right? We all always are flowing through God. God flows through God. There's no obstruction in God. There's nowhere where we cannot flow through. But what we can't do is place any limitation upon it. We cannot make a God out of limitation. There is no limitation. So this is nice rhetoric. Yeah, it's great. It's helpful maybe to just touch a little bit upon this. But this will be our direct experiencing once a frame of reference shift takes place. And we have to understand that we're a little bit scared about that, right? I'd be like, well, wait a minute, you know, where are the boundaries? What happened to my boundaries? No boundaries, never any boundary. What? We might say, well, this is a nice experience for a while, like a ride at some amusement park. You're like, wow, I'm flowing through everything simultaneously. You know, there's no limitation to it. I can do it all simultaneous, or I can do just this or just that, but there's no barriers, time, space barriers at all. And you say, well, this is great. And you'll say, for now it's great, but you know, for a little while. But then you say, you know, I mean, I'm kind of getting a little jittery now. Where are the boundaries again? I kind of lost sight of them. You know, and then, you know, we get jittery, and then we go back into panic or shock. We go back into shock, what we do. And the experience stops for us. So it happens like that. This is fun, but then gradually, where are the boundaries? I'm not seeing any. What do I need to flow around? I'm flowing through everything, but what do I need to flow around? I gotta keep practicing that too. You know, I don't see any way to practice this. I keep flowing through everything. My creativity keeps flowing through everything. What do I need to flow around? I can't find it, and then you start getting nervous and saying, "Man, you know, I'm getting out of shape. I need to stay in shape flowing around stuff." You know, what we call this universe, everything flowing around. Oh, this is an obstruction, but I can flow around it somehow. I got to stay in shape. And then you think, oh, I'm going to get really out of shape. It's kind of like if you just like are sleeping all the time and you're just lounging around all the time. And maybe you might do it for several weeks. And then at some point you say, man, I'm getting really out of shape. This is scary. I better get back and, you know, hit, you know, start exercising again. And that's like what happens. That's what happens. So we don't try to push that issue, you know, because the yo-yoing back, you know, it's not good. You don't want to yo-yo too much. Try to keep it more steady. If that experience arises, just let it arise and let it play, and understand that we're still holding on to the concept of indefinite definition. So what are we flowing around? We're flowing around an indefinite definition is what we're flowing around. I mean, okay. I mean, I have something I can flow around? Yeah, indefinite definition. I can flow around that still. Oh, good. Okay, great. I was getting worried there that I couldn't ever find anything again. I'd get totally out of shape, and I wouldn't know how to function in the new reality, you know? I gotta stay in ready for that new reality, too, you know? This old reality is great, you know, it's wonderful, but I gotta get ready for the new reality of flowing around stuff. I'm just being, you know, comical, of course, but this is how we really feel. So, yeah, I got something to flow around. The indefinite definition. The wow. I'm going to flow around the wow for... Oh, great. I'm just flowing around the wow now. And then everything gets back to familiarity. You feel, oh yeah, this is familiar. But you don't go into panic. See, panic is saying, I can't find anything to flow around. This is horrible. It's terrible. I'm gonna be annihilated. I won't get into the new reality. Oh, I gotta find so many things. Here's one. Here's another. And you go in this frantic search for as much as possible. You get greedy. Oh, I need so many things to flow around. Oh, I need more. And then you waste all that effort and time and energy. Whereas we just say, no, I have one thing to flow around. I'm happy with that. I just flow around the wow. I'm just flowing around the wow for now. I have this vast river of creativity, and I'm just this little rock in the river, in the middle of the river, this little rock, the wow rock. And the whole river is just flowing around this wow rock. Okay, great. No problem. So I'm just calm, just relaxed, not frantic, not pushing. I say, this is still familiar. I mean, the creativity's flowing around this wow, this little rock of wow, this indefinite definition, this little indefinite definition. So that's keeping me in shape. That's all I need to stay in shape. That's all I need. So you see how this cools it down, calms it all down, calms your mind all down. It's like a miracle. It is a miracle that we have come across this, because it doesn't often be clarified. We don't often get this clarification. We don't often come across this. It's like a miracle. I got this wow shirt yesterday. I rarely do anything like that. But I had to return something that didn't fit, and the alternatives didn't fit either. And I said, wow, and I can't get anything. There was some hat that didn't fit. I needed to get a new exchange for one that did. The hat was like a medium small. And I said, no, it doesn't fit. It's too small. So they said, well, we have a large, extra large. That's the only other. We have two. Medium and small, and large, extra large. So I said, great. I took the large, extra large, put it on my head. Boom, like a bucket, you know, dropped over my ears. And I said, holy cow. I look like an idiot. I said, how's it look? I said, I don't know. So then I tried all the other hats on, you know, this, but none of them look so good. I said, nah, it's not me, I don't know. And finally I said, what can I do? I said, do I have to exchange a hat for another hat? They said, no, you can exchange it for any merchandise you want. I said, great, what? I said, God, what do I do? I don't know. I said, look at the shirts. So I looked at this one shirt, I said, boom, love at first sight. I said, oh my God, I love this shirt. So, but they only had XL, so I tried it on, it fit great. The fit was just, everything was the best shirt I've ever come across in my life. It's a wow shirt. It's so relaxed. The shirt is so relaxing and comfortable. It's like the perfect wow shirt. I said, yeah, let's get that. And I got a little wow visor too. I said, that's enough. Let's just flow around that. I'm happy. See, just a little visor and a shirt and I'm happy. That's it. And then let's just hang out. Let's just hang out at the pool and just do nothing. Because my creativity is flowing around the wow. I'm staying in shape. I'm staying in shape for absurdity. You know, just in case a new reality occurs, right? I gotta stay in shape for that. It's too scary to abandon that totally forever right at this point. I want to assure I feel comfortable flowing through everything before I abandon the notion of flowing around something, right? But I'm not panicking, saying I've got to flow around so many different things, this. I got to induce happiness somehow, so I stay happy flowing around stuff. I say, no, I know I'm not going to be happy. The wow's not going to make me happy. But it'll keep me from panicking, that's for sure. And keep me from delaying, that's for sure. And keep me available to reality, glimpses of it, that's for sure. So that's the best I can do. That's the best I can do. It's the best I can do. So here you go. Here's your 7-year channel here. YouTube, just 7-year, the 7-year channel. period. Just accept 7 years. I've gone through now seven-year periods of intense training. Seven-year periods, 49 years, and I'm starting the 50th. So now I can present this in my 50th year. I can present this to you, a seven-year cycle for you, for everyone here, everyone that believes that they can't flow around flow through a universe, that they have to somehow flow around a universe. A universe full of flowing around stuff, things. For those who still are used to that, you know, I can present this way to avoid the worst of it. I can present this way to avoid the worst of it. Hallelujah. Can I get a hallelujah from anyone? Just say wow. Can I get a wow from anyone here? Can I get a wow from anyone? Truly, truly. Not a contrived wow, but even that. I mean, flow around that. Just say, yeah, I'm going to flow around the wow for 7 years. No problem. I can guarantee you that 100% plus of you will be flowing around something for the next 7 years. Will still be believing you have to flow around something. So just accept right now. The secret is to accept the wow. I'll be flowing around the wow for the next 7 years. No. And then you will have this grace-filled 7 years, actually. So will I be protected? Sure. Because I don't... grace of God is not going to throw away a goose that's laying golden eggs. Okay. The golden eggs... wow eggs... eggs of wisdom. I'm going to flow around just the wow. No, nothing else. I don't need anything else. Just that one little, the one little rock in the stream is the river is all I need for now. Yeah. We'll all be protected. Anyone who chooses this will be protected. Anyone who chooses this will be protected from being swept away into panic. So are 7 year cycles doable? I've done seven of them. Yeah, I've done seven of them consecutively. Seven-year cycles I've completed. I've completed them. So of course a 7 year cycle is doable. It's not a retreat. It's not a 7 year retreat. Okay, so we don't need to talk about retreats anymore. That's overcooking it. It's just a 7 year cycle. You can do a 7 year cycle of my creativity is just flowing around. Wow. That's all it's flowing around. I'm just going to keep focus on that. But how do you do a 7 year cycle? One day at a time. Now, balance, physical exercise or whatever you do physically. Balance is important. I tried something new today I hadn't done before, and I was just like, wow. I was on this, I get like a 4-inch piece of heavy duty PVC, like Schedule 40 or ABS. I think ABS is the gray stuff. That's really nice. It's expensive. That's for like plumbing, heavy pressure stuff. I think it's 4-inch. And, yeah, I get like about 8 feet of it. I get 8 feet of 4-inch. And then I walk along and I put it in some grass. So don't put it on concrete. It's too slippery. Put it on grass so it kind of slides a little bit, can kind of turn a little bit. Or sand or something. It's got to kind of sink down a little bit in something. So you don't put on a hard surface like wood or concrete or anything. It's too dangerous. You know, and of course check with your your doctor before you do any exercise. any balance work, you have to be careful, of course. And I walk along a certain direction, and then I try to walk back the other direction, changing my orientation. Goofy foot, so to speak. It's difficult. But what I did now is I step on it, and I'm perpendicular. I'm facing perpendicular. And the two ends are going like this way. And I'm facing perpendicularly away from the two ends, but 90-degree angle. And so my feet are there. And then I turn one direction, and I'm walking in that direction. I'm turned that way. And then I turn my body the other direction, and I'm walking back the other way. And wow, it's like different exercise. I said, oh, this is really good exercise for these times. Really great. neither crucifixion, don't induce, neither crucify yourself nor try to induce happiness, right? Just be that little island in the river, the wow island. Still flowing around that, still flowing around. So you know you're not going to have happiness because you're still flowing around something, okay? But you're only flowing around one thing, okay? You're just flowing around one thing, nothing else, but just that one thing. But you still won't be happy, you know that. But you've accepted it. So for this next 7 years, you won't be happy, okay? But you will have reduced, you'll get really familiar with only flowing around one thing, nothing else, just that one thing. Then from that point, it's very easy to just say, oh, you know what? I don't even need to flow around one thing. You see how that works? You consolidate all your flowing aroundness, which we have a whole universe of just, I'm just flowing around one thing. But I'm committed to just flowing around that one thing for now. Okay, for now. This is really the entire secret key to success. I'm just going to flow around one thing. Well, I'm just going to have one definition that I flow around. In the indefinite definition. I am indefinite. I am wow. I'm the concept of indefinite definition. That's what I am. That's what I'm flowing around. My creativity flows around that. Doesn't flow through it. It flows around it. But that's it. There's nothing else. I'm just focused on this fact. I'm not worrying about trying to flow around other stuff or flow through other stuff. I'm not trying to flow through anything. I'm just saying I'm not flowing through just one thing. I'm not flowing through just one thing. Just indefinite. What is it? It's wow. It's an indefinite definition. It's an indefinite rock, you might say. It's an indefinite definite rock. So it's a concept. It's an indefinite definite concept, and my creativity is flowing around that. It doesn't flow through it yet. Not right now. And just say, I just stay with this. Easy. Just stay with this. Even when I have breakthroughs, I'll stay with it. I'll stay with it for 7 years. Just a phase, a 7-year phase. 7-year phase. 7-year cycle. I'll just stay with it. And if the frame of reference happens at some point, hey, it'll happen. And there'll be no worries because that means I was ready for it. And so there'll be no problems with that at all. If I'm ready, there won't be any problems, you see. So I don't need to worry about that. I'll just keep working on getting ready. That's all. And most likely, for most of us, 100% minus, we'll spend the 7 years getting used to this, just flowing around just one concept, one thing, this one concept, indefinite definition. Most of us, and we'll just get used to that. But that, then our whole mind will become so simple. It'll be so simplified for us. It's so simple, and we forget about panic. We'll get more and more like panic. I don't know what that is. I know what shock is, but panic really is foreign to me. Very foreign. I'm not even interested in anymore at all. And when panic's gone, when shock then becomes the lowest, right? Then it becomes so much easier to just flow through everything. Frame of reference shift. Flowing through everything. Spontaneous, instantaneous, creative flow through all creativity. Creativity flowing through itself, you might say. Creativity flowing through itself. Any which way at all. And this opens up, infinite, endless creativity, doesn't it? Never-ending, eternal creativity, which is wonderful, which is reality. Hallelujah. Wow. Yeah. Oh, man. Maybe I'll do a transcript of this as a book, you know? I don't like writing books and saying this is the structure, this is this. But like a transcript of this would be interesting, wouldn't it? slideshow would be interesting of some of the key things, but the video is better because you know it's more creative, isn't it? You can feel the intensity of it here. You get the feel of what it's like more than right reading a book. Reading a book, you're not sure. Well, what, you know? Can someone at least give me the feel of it? Can I get the livingness of it? Can I get the richness, the context of you know? A book is just like a wall of words. You know, it's like, wow, how am I supposed to get it from that book? So videos to me are more valuable, except people don't watch them. They only watch 10 minutes or something. That's not enough. It's funny because people will spend 2 hours reading a book, won't they? But they won't spend 2 hours watching a video. Whereas videos are more valuable. They're more valuable. You get. It's more helpful, which is what people don't want. they want more delay. You know, they want spiritual rhetoric. Give me a book full of spiritual rhetoric, so I can feel more comfortable about delaying absurdity and hoping the chronic abnormality becomes normal. Yeah, that'll help me. I think that'll help me delay. So most 100% minus are into delay, and they just say, show me a better way to delay. But here, we don't show a better way to delay. We show the ultimate way. But see, that's it. We don't go anywhere else. But the ultimate way to delay honors our creativity to such an extent, then we relent. We say, wow, yeah, that really was a very graceful exit. You know, the ultimate way of delay also has to be the ultimate way of a graceful exit too, from delay, doesn't it? It has to have that. It has to have the ability to openness to flowing through creativity. It has to. So that's why wow is the ultimate way. It's the ultimate way. It's the ultimate delay, you might say, because it has the end of delay within it in a graceful way. That's what makes it ultimate. So it's been difficult to get to this because some of the others were saying, well, this is ultimate, da 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 da. And so I had a difficult time. I said, no. I know a way that really is truly ultimate. Because it's in the ultimate form of delay, but we're conscious of the whole thing and why, and has its own ending within it in a graceful way, a very graceful way, because we've honored our creativity through this ultimate delay, which is what we're really aiming for anyway. And the whole purpose of this flowing around a universe was to find some ultimate delay. So we say, yeah, we did find it, and yet it has a graceful ending to it, you see. So that's what makes it ultimate. So I had a difficult time getting to this. I came into the world to give this out to the world, but I had a difficult time because there were so many interfering with it by claiming, I am the ultimate, and worship me, you know, and do this. I said, well, no, I'm bringing in the real ultimate. The true ultimate, which is paradoxical because we're consciously, intentionally delaying, you know? Like, no, I'm going to be this rock in the river. You're going to flow around the wow. And nobody thinks to look there. They don't think to look there. They're still trying to induce happiness, which is grandstanding, which they think that the quicker way is to make abnormality the new normality. That seems quicker. They say that we're almost there. It's so chronic. We should be able to just a few more moments, and we should become feel normal to us. So they keep on with this, all the bells and whistles and spiritual rhetoric and stuff. Of thinking this is the ultimate. No, it's not. It might be the ultimate folly, you know, but we're not after ultimate folly. We're after ultimate success here. So we're in the ballpark here of ultimacy, okay? We're in that echelon here. We don't need to worry about this issue. We're in the ballpark of ultimacy. However anyone else might want to spin it, it's still just going to be in the ballpark of ultimacy, right? We're already in this ballpark of ultimacy. We're here. We made it. We made it to ultimacy, really. We made it. Just in time, just in the nick of time, right? Just in the nick of time, yeah. Just, but that's how it always works out with me. I always, right before, you know, just it's too late. I manage to do it. And that's the way probably it goes with us, right? I mean, procrastinate, worry, fret, and then realize, wow, we got this deadline, and then that deadline produces this. This focus, so that it happens. It happens for us. So it's happened for us. We're in the ballpark of ultimacy, and this is all we need to be. That's all we need to be. That's, we don't need to be in any other ballpark. The game that's played here will be sufficient for us. Okay, the graceful exiting of delay, right, through honoring our creativity. We don't want to get rid of all obstacles to the flow of creativity, because that's been our whole effort. That's our whole effort to flow around, to become expert at flowing around, so that becomes the new reality, and so we're honoring that. That's the key, you know. That's part of the key component. There's this little constellation of key components, you know, expectation, you know, familiarity, fear, and then honoring our creativity. We've got to get familiar with truth, plus we have to honor our creativity. We've been so creative, haven't we, about flowing around. Like this is the new reality. The new reality is flowing around instead of flowing through. Creativity flowing around other creativity instead of creativity flowing through creativity. We've tried to create a new reality. And we've been so creative with that, we really feel like we want to honor it. And I feel the same way. I feel that way. So I know that that's delaying me, but I accept it. I accept it because we really have just been, you know, just it's been an amazing sojourn, this universe of trying to use creativity to change creativity. And when I say just me, I mean I'm speaking for everyone. I mean we've all been experiencing. We're all experiencing this universe, which is a collective creative endeavor of our one creativity. Our one creativity has been working on this, and we have been witnessing to it collectively here, and involved with it, and just perceiving it all is you're part of it all. So we're all, you know, heavily invested in this creativity. So we all want a very great gracious exiting of this, a very gracious exiting. And this is what we have here. And it makes all the difference. Because deep down you feel the graciousness of it, and you're being gracious to yourself. You're being gracious to creativity. Creativity is being gracious to creativity. Very, very powerful. That's in the ultimate sphere. It's in the sphere of ultimacy. Ultimate. We're in the ultimate ballpark here, right? It's the ultimate. To feel that graciousness. Feel it. We're being gracious to ourselves here. We're not attacking. We're not trying to kill the ego, attack the mind, get rid of this. That's a very ungracious way. It doesn't work well at all. We're here. We're very gracious to ourselves, and so just accept this gracious exit, this gracious way, and then your experiencing will coincide with that. You say, "No, I'm still going to flow around the wow," and that wow may be in an environment, you know, right? Maybe very beautiful. You may end up very beautiful places, very beautiful, and you understand. That's just the wow. I have that because I decided to just flow around just this one definition, the indefinite definition, this one concept. And this can result in very beautiful and serene surroundings, environment. And you feel like, oh yeah, my creativity is flowing through everything else, but it's still, I'm still just going to accept that it flows around this. It flows through everything else, but it's flowing around this. And so we don't know exactly how our environment is going to be. It's been intimated and shown to me it could be very beautiful, very gracious. You might say your environment reflects the graciousness. This is a good, great way to put it, is you will find yourself in a situation that feels very gracious. Very, very gracious, like you. So how can I explain this? Well, just this graciousness, this wonderful graciousness. Because you're being wonderfully gracious to yourself, you're choosing to be wonderfully gracious, and that will be then your experiencing. Hallelujah, really, right? Guess what? We don't have to go through all the harshness, the ungracious way to try and attack, induce and attack. We don't have to go through that. Not only does it not work 100% minus of the time, it's also very ungracious. And you can feel that in the world. The world's become a very ungracious place, hasn't it? Exactly. Because we're trying to make an to delay by trying to make an ungracious exit. That simply delays us because we reject it. So it just ends up It's that's pan, that spirituality of panic is this very ungracious delay. Kill the ego type of thing. Kill the mind. Okay, that's actually the spirituality of panic. Spirituality of shock is to make this very gracious exit. And so our experiencing will be very gracious, very beautiful, a feeling of wonderful graciousness. So we just, everywhere we turn, we just see, oh, this is so. Such a feeling of graciousness everywhere. Gentle, gentle exit. Gentle exit. Gracious, gentle exit. Very gracious, very gentle exit. That'll be our experiencing. Literally, that will be our experiencing. However that comes about, it will come about. It will come about. So we don't really need to worry about the harshness of the world, and that's not our. That's just the game of delay. That's all. We're not doing that anymore. That's a game of panic. We have a different life. We have the life of shock, not the life of panic. Very different life. It's symbolized like the sheep and the goats. The sheep is this life of shock, but it has a very gracious experiencing. Gracious exit, very gracious. And the goats, they're searching, they're trying to induce happiness, and they're searching everywhere, and they're just into everything, every which way try to induce happiness. That's the life of panic. The sheep have a life of shock, the goats have a life of panic. Very different destinies in this short term, in terms of what their environment will be like. Those who are the sheep will have a very gracious environment. Exceedingly gracious. Those the goats will have an exceedingly harsh environment. Exceedingly harsh. This is how it is now. As we are making our decision, which one do we want to go? Which one do we really want to go for? Because oscillation is still panic. Okay? So if we choose shock, we're not into oscillation, except we use wow as wow as our, honoring our creativity with oscillation there. Wow as wow. Gracious way to honor our creativity about oscillation. So, I've lived my whole, I've the experience that you will live is reflective of whether you're living a life of panic or a life, choose to live a life of shock. And the life of shock will lead you to more and more gracious experiencing. The term gracious living, it's true. You feel just like when you experience it, you just say, wow. It just feels so much graciousness here. And the whole environment feels to be saturated with it. It just feels so full of grace, graciousness. so gentle, like there's this really gentle exit I'm making from the notion of creativity having to flow around something. I'm making a very gracious exit from that, very gentle and gracious exit. So everything will feel very gentle and gracious in an effortless way, not in a fabricated way. It just feels unfabricated and effortless. It just feels this way. A reduced intensity zone. The harshness just is not there. It just doesn't feel harsh at all. And the graciousness as such, it is. It's the suchness of it. What can you say? It's just to be experienced. You don't feel like saying anything about it. When you're really in graciousness, you don't feel like needing to define it. It's obvious. You just say, I just feel like experiencing it. I just feel like enjoying it. That's all. That's all. I don't feel like explaining it. I just feel like enjoying it. Then you know you're in a very gracious environment. Very gracious indeed. That's how you will know. You won't even feel like defining it, explaining it. No. Don't feel like it. Not necessary. I got the feel of it. I just enjoy it. Just enjoy it. Just effortlessly enjoying it. Seamlessly, effortlessly. Just wow. Wow, wow, wow. All right. Tumultuous here in California. The weather, very tumultuous. Very, August for me usually is very gracious. I was born in the month of August. And for me, it's a very gracious time of the year. I like it when it's just hot and quiet and still. And everything just seems to be at rest and feels very gracious and quiet in August. You know, before people going back to school, it's still summer. It's the end of summer, and it's supposed to be hot, and you know, you've had this whole summer of relaxed vacation, and you just sort of, you've gotten away from the push of school, right? So it's sort of like the summit of graciousness. I was born right then, nowadays they go back to school on the 16th. Before, we didn't go back to school till September, actually. So the idea is that I was born in the second third, towards the second half of August, you could say second half of August, and that's when the mellowness of summer reaches its peak, and you just feel like I could just stay this way in shorts and t-shirt and this gracious feeling. I could just feel it, stay this way forever. That's how I've always felt. I just want to stay this way forever, in this graciousness, until the frame of reference shift takes place. So I was born then, and so I've always relished the second half of August. It's just such a wonderful time. And yet now, it's not anymore. So I've got to do something else. It's not anymore. This second half of August here has been weird. Almost all of August here has not been August. It's got to be the coolest August ever, and the windiest, and the most, the atmosphere is so lousy and yucky and cloudy. It just feels like the sky is all washed out. Everything's washed out. Usually we have these azure skies, these beautiful azure, the lazy, hazy days. But if the haze is low, kind of hangs low, and the sky is still azure, you know, and you just feel like, oh, this is perfect. Now, the sky looks whitish. The blue, you can hardly see the blue of the sky at all. That's how bad it is. It's not even smog. It's kind of smoke and haze, and I don't know what it is. It may be from the fires up north. It's a combination of fire, smoke, and heavy fog at the coast, And it's just a combination, and it's just so yucky. So my August has been ruined. That means God is about ready to do something else for me as far as gracious living, graciousness. Saying this NorCal thing is not working out for you anymore, is it? I say, no. Last straw was ruining my August. I said, that's it. I look forward to that all year long. I've always looked forward to August to say, at least I get 1 month of the year. That's wonderful. And California's given me, like, last 5 years has been gracious, nonstop. It's been wonderful, but not this year. This year has been anything but gracious. It's been stormy. It's been turbulent. The summer has been lousy. You know, it's just the weather has been weird. Not so gracious anymore here. And that reflects the attitude, of course, of Northern California. Which is, again, panic-based, very much panic-based, attempting to induce, delay-based, using induction of superficial happiness to make sure that delay keeps happening. And super push here, frantic, not laid back here. It's not laid back. Maybe you go up, you know, further up north, but they're also frantically trying to induce in different ways. They're trying to induce it through being laid back, you know, pot country up northern California, Humboldt, Mendocino, all this place, you know, just intense. Whole state's becoming an intense center of marijuana cultivation and usage. It's going to become legal, I believe, in January, most likely, unless the feds step in. And so, you know, no, that's the attitude. That's all panic-based. It's a very panic-based place right now. So it's not my California anymore, at least this part. not at all. It never really was my California, actually. No. Because the push has always been going on here. It's gotten now. It's just, you know, the fruit of the push is what? Frantic push. Almost like panic. People are like in a panicky condition. The push is so severe here. Really driving here, you feel like at any moment, you know, violence could break out here. Just the driving is so intense. But people still let me in. Like I said, that man yesterday, go ahead, you know, I'm not in such a rush that I can't show you a kindness here, you know, so that still happens to me, but, you know, there's a few people, I still let people in all constantly, no problem. I can see your lane is ending, construction. You need somewhere to go, no problem, I'll slow down, let you in front of me. Most people will say, sure, I'll let you in, but I'll let you in behind me. Okay, but the only problem is the car behind them says the same thing. So this is the insanity, the absurdity that panic gets into. So like for instance, people here in the Bay Area, most of them now at this point, think they're wonderful. You know, very nice, civil people, and they say, "Oh, I see. You need to get the construction zone. Your lane is getting pinched off. You need to get in. I see that, and I'm a really nice person too." So I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll let you in behind me. I'll give you space behind me. Okay. And then the next car says the same thing. And the next car says the same thing. And before you know, you've been there for 5 minutes. Every car says the same thing. I'm a nice person. I'm going to let you in behind me. Finally, you find somebody. Sometimes it's some guy in a pickup truck, you know, like laid back. Said, hey, man, no problem. I'm not in a big rush to get anywhere, you know. I'm mellow. Here, go in front of me. I'm a nice guy. Go in front of me. Oh, thank you very much. And next time I'll pass the love on, you know. I'll pass the shock-based way on. Okay. You see? And so then someone does that to me. I see somebody and they're getting pinched. And I say, hey, I'm a nice guy. I'll let you in front of me. How about that? I get into trouble still. This truck, I was merging, and they didn't want to let me in front of them. I said, "What are you doing? Just let me in front of you. This big truck." Bonk, honk. I said, "My God, I had to just floor it to get in front of him." I said, "This guy says no. I'm a nice truck driver, but I'll let you in behind me." What are you doing? A truck's going 55 on the freeway. They're supposed to be going 55. Trucks are going 70 now. It's crazy. Nobody, it's so difficult now with this attitude. Everybody, of course, feels very self-righteous here. If you tell anyone in the barrier that they're not really nice people, they will get very indignant with you. I mean, almost to the point of attacking you. Violent, almost violently indignant right now, actually. The world is on the point of violent indignation if you should even suggest that they may not be as nice as they think they are. Because they're saying, "Of course I'm nice. There's a spot behind me." But I said, "There's 10,000 others behind you. They feel the same way, so I'm not being treated nicely at all, am I?" "Well, that's not my problem. That's their problem. They're the ones not letting you in. I'm letting you in behind me." "Well, they're saying the same things. I'm nice. I'm letting you in behind me." You see how that just blocks graciousness? Completely blocks it, doesn't it? But of course, not a single one of them will admit that they're not wonderful people. And don't you dare suggest that they're not. So we're on the verge of violent indignation in this country. Very, very much on the brink of violent indignation. How dare you suggest that I'm not just a completely wonderful person, very fair and just. I'll let you in behind me. I say, "Well, how about letting me in front of me? Because that's how a civil culture works. When somebody needs to make a turn, they have a right to the road. They have to navigate the road too. And when you're in the same situation, I'll let you in front of me also, because we need to zipper in. When you're merging, you need to zipper in. How about that?" "What, are you saying I'm not a nice person?" And so immediately they go into this indignation of panic. The panic produces violent indignation. Should you even address it at all? It doesn't. It feels it's unimpeachable, because why? It's delaying. And them letting you in behind them is their way of trying to induce their own happiness, you see, and which is delaying, which they think is the only way. So what you're telling them is the only way that they can see isn't right, and so they get violently indignant. Big, big problem right now. And I don't, how to solve that problem, it's up to God, the grace of God. It's such an intense problem right now. I'm scared, because you want to speak up and say, "Hey, what are you doing?" Everybody feels that way. A friend of mine went to the to get some pick up some fast food, and they came back, and someone else was talking to them, saying, "Oh, this is such a wonderful place we live. People are so civil. They let you in." And they say, "What are you talking about? I was in the parking lot, and there were this parking space, and I was in line for it, and somebody zoomed in and took it right in front of me. I was there waiting, it was my turn, and they zoomed right in front of me, and it happened twice." And she was so mad. She was furious, furious with this. You're like, what? How dare these people do that? And they will say, "Well, no, I'm leaving another parking space for you. Or you can have this parking space after I'm done. I mean, that's nice. What's wrong with that? What's not nice about that?" And so you feel like reprimanding people here constantly. But then you say, "Wait a minute, it could erupt violently if I even reprimand them at all." So this is the situation we're in right now, especially in the United States, is any reprimand to these self-righteous people, and the country's full of them, you feel that it can erupt in violent indignation, very violent indignation. And it's almost bound to happen now. It's almost bound to happen. At any moment, the tinder is so dry, it's just a little spark can spark the entire thing right now. Can spark and just, absolute violent indignation can take place now. Just by someone saying, "Hey, wait a minute. How about, showing a little bit of graciousness here? What? Your graciousness is behind me. That is my that's the only graciousness I have to give you. And if you don't like it, you're bad. You're wicked. You're terrible. I say, wait a minute, I'm not terrible. I'm just asking. No, you're terrible. Shut up. You know. And then if you say anything more, it's violence. Violence. So it's a nervous time. I'm nervous. I'm nervous because it's pretty difficult to not say anything at all when you're constantly up against this notion of somebody saying, I'm a super great person, and you can use the parking space after I'm done. That's like all super nice, isn't it? Well, that's the niceness of delay, but it's not the niceness of shock. It's not wisdom-based, it's panic-based. And what they're basically saying is, we don't want any shock-based culture in the world at all. We want just panic-based culture. We want to get rid of the wisdom of shock-based culture entirely, and that's what'll work. And we're right, and you're wrong, so you're going to do it our way. End of story. It's very dictatorial, you know, very dictatorial. And if anybody stands up and says, hey, wait a minute, you know, there's value in shock-based culture, which is traditional, conservative, religious-based type of culture. It's a shock-based culture. It allows for graciousness. There's not as much push, okay? You're not searching for all these different stuff. You settle on one thing, you know, one, just allow just this one, my creativity to flow around just this one issue, you know. Here we say, it's the wow. It's very clearly laid out. Very gracious type of culture. You don't feel this frantic, agitated, panicky push. Okay? They want to get rid of that culture. They want to get rid of it. And they think this is the righteous thing to do. And so if we stand up and say, hey, wait, we don't want to get rid of this. They're on the edge of violent indignation at this point. So, yeah. It's alarming, to say the least, and I can't say a word. I can't say a word here. I can't say even a word to anyone. I just have to get slapped in the face over and over and over. I might just say, oh, you know. I just give a thumbs up, you know, great. Someone showed me that. I was driving on this road, gridlock. And it was hectic, people trying to get here and there, and the lights, you know, the way it was. And it was such a madhouse. I was focused on the car in front of me, and I don't want to make a mistake in this hecticness. So I wasn't focused peripherally as much, because I was really stressed out by just how frantic, a day full of this frantic driving. I was stressed out. I said, I just don't want to hit the car in front of me. You know, just please get me home. And I didn't see peripherally that someone in the parking lot had pulled out to exit the parking lot. I didn't see it because I got blinders on at that point because my stress level was through the roof. And so I happened to be the car that was now blocking them from getting out. And then, but I had enough awareness to look, and I said, look, I saw him, I said, oh, and he just sort of raised his hand like, great, like that. Now he's being sarcastic, like, great job, you know, great job. But he didn't have the graciousness to just, you know, at least he had some gracious, like, thumbs up. But it was sort of a sarcastic thing, so I probably shouldn't do that either. It was obvious, like saying, what an idiot, you know. But he didn't understand that I didn't do it purposely at all, because 99% of the time I would have caught that, and I'd say, okay. But I had already blocked it, you know, just at the same time, you know. So it was, I didn't have perfect awareness, right? But he dissed me for not having perfect awareness. I said, look, buddy. In this gridlock, that's going to happen. You know, it's not that I intentionally tried to block you. It's just the push is so insane here from every direction that occasionally that's going to happen. You know, even nice people are going to be in your way sometimes here. But nobody will even cut you slack for that. And so we have to remember that it getting blocked like that, it occasionally, even nice people are such that it's going to happen. But we end up getting frustrated and angry at everybody now. You know, everybody's angry at everybody here. So I should not even mockingly say, hey, great job. Just act like nothing's happened. You know, just the way to do it is just say, I'm not going to even make any gestures. Like, not even friendly gestures. Like, hey, great job there, buddy. No, that was a hostile thing he did. You know, it was like, I really want to hit you, but I'm just saying, I'm not hitting you. I'm a wonderful person because I'm not hitting you. But he wanted to. He wanted to. And I said, that's wrong. He should have just said, there should be something like, hey, no problem, man. But there's no way. How do you convey that? Because people think that they're being mocked. How do you say no problem? Just smile and nod. No problem, man. No problem. Just have this feeling like it's okay. It's okay. I understand that you're getting pushed so severely. You didn't catch this perfectly. That a car was coming in a parking lot that might want to get out. And then you put on the brakes because there's such a push to get through this traffic like I just got through. And I was thinking that what happened was I was thinking the light ahead was going to be green and suddenly it turned red. And so I got, you get caught in between when it's gridlock. You get caught in uncomfortable situations. I thought the traffic was going to continue on and suddenly it stopped because somebody else was, what happened was crosswalk. Somebody went across a crosswalk and the cars in front of me suddenly stopped. I didn't look, that was up far ahead, I didn't see it. So how could I have seen, you know, that someone was going to jump the crosswalk, the cars would stop, and I get stuck there, and then the light turned red, so I couldn't go. So the guy's blaming me, you know, for that. That's wrong. That's wrong. We need to realize that when there's all these pedestrians and traffic lights and gridlock, that you occasionally you're going to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. It happens to the best of us. It happened to the best of us. I didn't see the crosswalk issue up, you know, five cars ahead or whatever, you know? Because I was worried about a lot of stuff. But no slack, you know, no slack. So you have to just figure, okay, you know, everybody's doing their best. There's a lot of people here who are not nice, but we don't want to turn it into a situation where everybody feels that everyone else, we have this righteous indignation at everyone, you know, and just feel like, how dare you say anything? Just how do you cool it out? Well, you can't, because everyone, even the nice people now, you realize they're just saying to heck with it, you know. People are driving on the shoulders of freeways now. They just say, I just can't take it anymore. They're turning the shoulder into lanes. Into lanes. That happened to me yesterday. Going home, it slowed down, traffic for the beach, it was all gridlock, slowed down, and I said, okay, it's going to take like an extra 2 minutes to get to my exit, fine. And there's a shoulder there, and I said, yeah, there's enough room there on the shoulder to drive there, but that's not the right thing to do, because if I do it, the other people say, look at that bum, he's saving 2 minutes, and I should do it too. Before you know, we're all doing it, right? And so I said, no, I'm not going to do it. Well, lo and behold, of course, a car behind me jumped into it and did it. And then another one jumped and did it. But you know what? The rest of us didn't do it. Only two cars did it. The rest of us said no. Now, the fact is, they weren't exiting. They ended up going straight, so they had no reason to jump over there. But I was exiting, but I waited until the exit lane opened up. Instead of just going on a shoulder of a freeway, which is totally illegal. Totally illegal. You know? I mean, if you want to do that, you could just go for miles on the shoulder of freeway and bypass all the slowed down traffic, you know. And then before you know it, everybody be doing that. And there's no emergency area. Then if someone's ready to hit someone else, they can't swerve over into that shoulder to avoid an accident. They won't be able to avoid accidents then. And the whole civility and safety breaks down when you do that. And it's happening here. You know, the whole thing of civility is just going to hell in the Bay Area. Very badly going to hell. And it makes you feel unsafe here. Very unsafe. So I'm feeling a very much unsafeness here in the Bay Area. Again, people on the edge of violent indignation, should you correct them about anything, they feel like they know what's right, period. And we say, well, wow is what's right, and nothing else is. That's it. Only that. Everything else is just nonsense. In other words, the shock-based life is what's right, because it gives us a gracious ending to delusion. And if you don't have a gracious ending to delusion, you're going to keep delaying and trying to make the chronically abnormal normal. You're trying to make chronicness into a power that changes reality. And that's what they're doing. But to tell them that it doesn't work, they don't want to hear it anymore. They said, shock-based culture didn't work for us. I said, well, you didn't try it in an intelligent enough way. You And if you didn't have it explained clearly enough to you, it got muddled. It got too muddled. The fact that it got muddled doesn't mean that if it was clear to you, that you wouldn't like it. You would like it. If it's clear to you, you're going to say, hey, I like this. This is going to work. But if it gets all muddled, then it doesn't work so well, right? And that's what happened. And so they're saying, it doesn't work at all. Panic, go back to panic, that'll work. And so they're pushing the panic thing as much as they can. This is the trouble now, big trouble. But we will have a gracious environment because we've decided for the wow, for a shock-based life, for the gracious way of relinquishing the creative effort to change creativity. So we will have the graciousness. It's just, I'd like to have it happen soon. Soon. Because it's not so gracious here anymore. It used to be. But I'm saying, God, this is not as gracious as I would like. And I have to drive through this all day long. And so it's really ungracious. I'm saying, no, this isn't right. So I'm, looking forward to a much more gracious situation coming up. We'll see. When it happens, it happens. You can't seem to rush grace. It has to be. It comes on its own terms in its own way. You just have to hang in there. But it's getting difficult to hang in the Bay Area. It's getting very difficult to hang in there. It's so ungracious. I mean, you can't go out your door without running smack dab into ungraciousness after ungracious after ungraciousness. And I enjoy homeless people because I can at least be gracious with them. And you know what? They're gracious back. Except one guy, actually, that's changed too. The last guy, he stopped and talked with me for a while whereas I'm waiting at a light. I gave him some money, and I've given him money before, and I like him. He said, I've been sober for 10 years. I said, that's wonderful. I said, blessings of God upon you that you can keep this sobriety going. And he says, I pray every day. I'm so thankful for that the grace of God has helped me out, and I'm trying to, I said, that's terrific, man. I'm with you 100%. And I said, we spend this gracious time as I'm waiting at a traffic light, and he's gracious enough to spend some time with me. Wonderful, thank you, big help. But the last homeless guy, there's a homeless guy, and we said, okay, let's give him some money. And he was like, high on meth or something, and he's like, grab the money, and then frantically walked further on. He was like totally frantic about everything. I was like, whoa, I've never had that happen before. So even the homeless people are frantic. Usually they're mellow. They'll at least give you a God bless. He couldn't even give me a God bless. He cut it off halfway. He was like totally spastic and really high on something. I was like, wow. So even the homeless people are no, you can't even get graciousness from them anymore here. That was a sign. Like, hey, I say, hey, it's worth me to give you some money because you're giving me some gracious, man. Actually, I should give you $100 for just 2 minutes of graciousness, because nobody else has got the time to be gracious. Homeless people don't have any work. I mean, they're just standing there. They can afford to be gracious, right? But the rest of the people, you can't even get a howdy from them. This old man at the park today, this morning, he was just sitting at the bench. He's just waiting to die. Then he got himself up as I was walking, started to walk toward him. I was walking, and he was back towards me. He got up from the bench and barely got up. I said, okay. And then he turned to walk somewhere, and there I was walking right towards him. And he smiled and said, he says, hello there. And I said, hi. He said, hi. Smiled, hi. And I gave him some graciousness, and an old lady came towards me. She said, hello, good morning. I said, good morning. So at least we give a good morning, a hello, a nod, a smile. That's, a little bit of graciousness there, right? So in shock-based culture, you can afford to be gracious with people. Wow is wow. Good morning, wow is wow. Good morning, I hope your suffering today is just moderate. May you have a moderate day of suffering today. Thank you, and God bless. May God bless your day. God bless your day. To see somebody say, may God bless your day. Thank you, may God bless your day as well. When people say, I don't say have a nice day anymore. I say have a great day. When someone says, and they're saying more and more, I'm helping spread this. They're like, "Hello, how are you? Have a nice day." Now I say, "Have a great day. Have a really great day." And when someone tells you that, I say, "I will. I really will. And you have a really great day as well." And they say, "Thank you. I will too." So actually, I've got this back. It's getting back now to me like that. See, that's a much more gracious way, right, of being, isn't it? Don't say, "Thank you. Have a nice day." Next. Say, "You know, I hope you have a really great day. Have a really great day, okay?" And then you answer, say, "You know, I really will." But before I said, "You too. You know, have a nice day. You too. Have a nice day. You too." Say, "No, I will." So acknowledge it. You know, they told you have a great day. So you know what? I really will have a great day. And you have a really great one, great day as well. And they say, "Thanks. I will too." So there's a way more gracious way of being. Just a little thing. And little things, and graciousness, little things mean a lot. Little things mean a lot like this. And how many times do we say, "Thank you, have a nice day," you know, buy something, okay, "Have a nice day, have a nice day. So we have so many opportunities, little opportunities, just to be gracious. It's like, "Oh, yeah, go in front of me." Like, there's a line, and somebody, especially an older person, go ahead, go in front of me. I'm not in any hurry. I tell them, "I'm not in any hurry, go in front of me." They say, "Oh, really? Yeah, no problem." I do that a lot. Don't go behind me, go in front of me. Like you're coming to a line that's backed up at a cashier and you see someone's coming and say, no. Or you're coming to a door, like going into a store, someone's behind you. What do you do? Well, I try to open the door and I open it for them. I say, go ahead, even though that means they get in line ahead of me. And then I get them a ticket and I say, "Here, you're in front of me, you take this ticket." And they say, "Oh, really? Yeah." I did that recently, and we ended up a conversation with the guy, a really nice conversation. Ended up, he knew a friend of mine, and I said, "Well, say hello to my friend," and we had a really nice conversation, because I said, I opened the door for him. I mean, he got inside the store first, which means but he didn't even get a ticket. I got a ticket for him, got two tickets, and I gave him the first ticket. I said, "You go in front of me. You were here before me," even though I was before him, because I was walking faster than him. I said, "Why should I have a right to be in line first just because I was walking faster than someone else?" I said, that's ungracious. That's not gracious, is it? I said, "You know what? I was being ungracious by walking faster to the door. So let me open the door and let you go first and you get in line first." And so we slow the whole pace down. I should have walked slower than you, so you got to the door first, right? So that's a gracious culture. Let me walk slower so you're first. Let me walk slower. Let me drive slower so you get to go in front of me. And that slows, the whole culture slows down and becomes much more gracious in that way. And the opposite is happening. But people are trying, aren't they? They're trying. But we're also sinking. You know, some are getting in lifeboats. We've got to get in lifeboats, God. Time to hit the lifeboats right now. It's the most important issue there is. Are you going towards a gracious, shock-based lifestyle? Or are you frantic, self-righteous, indignant, panic-based lifestyle? It's one of the two. It's sheep or the goats right now. It's one of the two. So let's remember to walk slower, to open the doors for people, let them go first. So don't try to butt in. If you see a situation where someone, you realize we're getting there kind of at the same time, immediately say, after you. I'm in no hurry, after you. No, I mean, life's wonderful, isn't it? I'm, you know, just getting by today without suffering too bad. That's wonderful. And I'm accepting the ultimate concept of wow. Definition, indefinite definition. I already have that. So I'm not seeking anymore. I'm not in hurry. I'm not in the frantic hurry of seeking. So I can handle a gracious environment. I've already got my graceful exit. I already know how to honor my creativity, how our creativity is honored. By wow. So, I'm in no hurry. I don't need to find anything. Even though I have the energy and the fitness to go fast, very fast, I can walk super fast. But no, I gotta remember, no, don't do that. Show some graciousness to everybody. "Hi, how are you? Have a wonderful day. Have a really great day. Have a really great relaxed day. Have a gracious day. Maybe I should say, "Hey, well, have a really gracious day." That's a good one to say. You know, okay, have a gracious day. Maybe we should say that. Have a really gracious day. Oh, thank you. I will. I will have a really gracious day. And you have a gracious day as well. So that's better than saying great. Say gracious. Have a gracious day. That's it. Yeah, I'm using that now. I'm trying to help everyone kind of get back to a more gracious way of living, you know. And if you pick the right people, they'll say, hey, thanks. Yeah, that's really wonderful. You don't want to be too religious. Don't have a Holy Spirit day. Just have a gracious day. Have a gracious day, because that's really where it's at anyway, isn't it? As we wait for a frame of reference shift to take place, some say after they may not get it this life, but after they die in purgatory, so, and that's true. You could have a frame of reference shift take place after this body, you know, is dropped. That can happen. It can happen in the afterlife. Absolutely, it can. They tell us it's not as easy there. It's not as easy. It's easier here because the focus here is so, the difference, you realize, if I don't have it, you know, I'm going to delay. It becomes the threat of that delay. It's very obvious to you. So you're more focused here. Okay, so it's easier here. But it can happen in the afterlife too. It can. So some great Christians, for instance, they'll say, you know, I just focus on Jesus and that's it. That's my one block, you know. It doesn't flow. Creativity doesn't flow there. It's my one little idol I have. But just one. And then they expect their frame of reference shift to take place in the afterlife. Well, that's fine. It can. It can happen that way. I wouldn't bank on it, though. See, I'm not banking on that. I want it to happen while I'm here. Okay? I want it to happen while I'm here. But if it doesn't happen while I'm here, it's going to happen in the afterlife. That this has been promised to me. You know, we'll get it done. You will not have to return to this realm. Okay, I'm not returning to this realm in order to have a frame of reference shift. I can return to this realm, but not for the purpose of a frame of reference shift. I'll already have had it if I happen to show up in this realm again. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. So have a gracious rest of your day. Have a very gracious rest of your day, and I will do the same, and we'll bring this one to a gracious ending here. Wow is wow. Wow is wow. The new way is indeed wow.